Welcome back to another edition of the Rodcast. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers. We'll introduce my man Patrick Davis, the real MVP, here in just a second. We got a lot to get into on the show. A lot of controversy right now in the NFL because the NFL is in the midst of their competition committee changing different rules. And one of the rules that they have changed is banning the hip drop tackle, which has caused a lot of heated debate among NFL fans. So we'll talk about that. Shohei Ohtani made a statement yesterday. We'll get into that and talk about the statement that Shohei Ohtani made and what may be the next domino to fall in the Shohei Ohtani saga right now that is kind of blown up right now in sports. We'll get also to Steve Sarkisian. We'll talk spring football. Steve Sarkisian spoke to the media after Texas had their spring practice and the media availability. They actually had a media window before practice, but the media availability after practice. We'll play a lot of that audio when we go behind the curtain. So we're going to talk Texas spring practice as well. We'll also talk Cowboys because we have some Mike McCarthy audio of him discussing free agency, which is for the Dallas Cowboys fans has been a very frustrating discussion because the Cowboys have made arguably the fewest transactions so far this new NFL year, this new calendar year. So we'll talk about that. We'll get into it. I got some numbers to share with you about that. There's also some D'Amico Ryan's audio. We'll get into that. There's also my man Brian Balding, who does a great job breaking down NFL film. He's talking about the Texans. We'll get to that audio. Shedeur Sanders, my rant of the day, Shedeur Sanders, Blake Monroe over at On Texas Football, does a great job. He has some audio that Shedeur Sanders had. I think he was just discussing, you know, being the underdog essentially. And he took a shot at 6A Texas high school football. So everybody in 6A high school football essentially took offense. And he also took a shot at the elite athletes that were in his class that played at the 6A level and also played in college football. So we'll play that audio coming up and have that discussion too. There's also my man Patrick with the Horn Headlines, the big fat poll of the day. We're also going to have the off the record. We got, you know, who said that. The show is loaded. So we got a ton to get to. Let's not waste any time. Let me introduce my man. He is the real MVP, one of the hardest working members of the ARN family. He's got a hustler spirit, period. I'm not sure what he's paid. I do know he's underpaid. He's got a hustler spirit, period. And I said he's a hustle man of many talents. Ain't no 401k for this hustler. He's a friend, a co-host, and also a neighbor. It's Patrick Davis, y'all. What's going on, brother? How you doing?
Oh, it's another Tuesday morning here in Austin. Let me introduce you to my co-host. My co-host is a proud alumni of DBU. He's got more papers than Dunder Mifflin and watches more film than Siskel and Ebert. He is the new Rod Father of Austin Sports Radio, Mr. Rod Babers.
I appreciate that intro as always. My man Patrick will have the Horn Headlines to get us educated and to get us informed of all the big headlines of the day. We'll also have the musically themed day of the week. If I'm not mistaken, it's one of my favorite, if not my favorite, musically themed day of the week coming up today. So we'll have that coming up at 6:45 as well. You can be a part of the show. We love when you guys participate on the text line 512-447-3776. All right, like I said, there's a lot of different items to talk about. I think we'll start with the Shohei Ohtani story and then start with the NFL rule changes and the hip drop tackle because we're going to get to Sark Sound in behind the burnt orange curtain. So we go behind the burnt orange curtain. That's when we'll get to the Sark audio and we'll talk Texas football. So I don't want to double up on it. So we'll start with some of the national headlines and stories and then we'll work our way. Also, my man Patrick will get us up, like I said, in the headlines. And I'm sure we'll get a chance to talk about the ladies, the Texas women. Now we know who their opponent is going to be coming up the next round of the NCAA tournament. Also a big topical conversation on 40 acres. So let's not waste any time. Let's get right to it. My man Patrick Davis will get us informed. We'll get us educated on the big headlines of the day in our Horn Headlines.
All right, your Horn Headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. The Texas women's basketball Sweet 16 matchup has been set. Gonzaga was able to handle Utah 77-66, outpacing Alyssa Pilley's 35 points to advance. Texas will take on the four-seeded Gonzaga on Friday night in Portland. In the NBA, all three Texas teams were in action last night. The Dallas Mavericks stopped the Jazz 115-105 with help from another Luka Doncic triple-double. With the help of the Spurs beating the Suns 104-102 in a game where Wembanyama did not play, the Mavericks move into a tie for the sixth seed with the Kings, who they will play tonight. And the Rockets were able to move into a half game of the 10 seed with a 110-92 win over the Portland Trailblazers. Jalen Green continued his hot scoring with 20 of his 27 points in the second half. Longhorn baseball team will close out a 10-game homestand tonight against Texas A&M Corpus Christi, where freshman Cole Selvig will be the probable starter. Texas is 25-5 all-time against the Islanders, winning their last five matchups, and that is your Horn Headlines.
Thank you for those Horn Headlines. I actually watched a little bit of that Zags Utah game last night, the ladies. And the Gonzaga ladies are a good squad. I obviously Texas women are better and expected to win that matchup. So we can talk a little bit about that coming up a little bit later on the show. Something we brought up that'll lead us into the Shohei Ohtani discussion. And I don't know if I jinxed the NBA or not. Yesterday, I did remark that the NBA hadn't had any gambling scandals. And I was just like, well, they haven't had, I'm talking about lately. I'm talking about recently. And the NFL has had to deal with some recently. They really, in the last 24 hours, it broke that they're investigating some irregularities in some of the unders for the Toronto Raptors, Jonte Porter. It just lets you know how, I mean, really this story, and I don't have no idea where it goes. It does show you that every sports league has their own investigative team, I'm sure, dedicated to this, whether it be data scientists, it's probably a combination of data scientists, the gambling platforms, companies, and some type of AI technology that really can essentially snuff out any possible corruption from the player side, so that they won't taint the game and taint the product. Because truly now they're making so much money in sports gambling, there is no need for the companies themselves and for anybody on the team to be to be corrupt in a sense where they're throwing games and they're throwing I guess now you can throw actual plays and series because you can bet actual live in game, and that's what this is about. This is about irregularities in the unders. So if you haven't heard the story, so Jonte Porter, and he's an undrafted player, so he's not necessarily a big time player. I believe he made his debut in the NBA in 2021. The issues with prop bets for Jonte Porter on the unders from January 26th to March 20th. They say multiple times they saw these irregularities against the Clippers. There was an increased betting interest on the under for Porter props, which for the night were set at 5.5, 4.5, 1.5. And there was also over under for Porter's made three pointers, which was just 0.5. It was just a half. And that evening, Porter played just 4 minutes. He left the game because the Raptors said it was an aggravation of an eye injury that he suffered earlier. He didn't score against the Clippers, had 3 rebounds, 1 assist, and he did not attempt a three. So all the unders hit, basically. The next day, DraftKings Sportsbook stated, and I'm sure this was just in the investigation, on Porter's three-pointers, that was the biggest money winner for bettors of any NBA player props from games that evening. And he played 19 minutes 2 days later, scored 12 points, had 7 rebounds and 3 assists. And on March 20th against the Kings, Porter played just 3 minutes before exiting with an illness of some kind. He did not score, attempting one shot and had 2 rebounds. Sportsbook had his over-under set at 7.5 points, 5.5 rebounds. The next day, DraftKings Sportsbook reported a media release that Porter's prop bets were the number one moneymaker from the night in the NBA. And they said that there were multiple betting accounts attempting $10,000 to $20,000 bets on this guy, Jonte Porter, on the unders, on those Jonte Porter unders for the Clippers game. And betting limits on NBA player props vary from sports books. Customers usually bet around $1,000 to $2,000 at the most. And they said, though, that was another irregularity that they were alerted to. So they're now investigating, and the coach, Rajakovic, I believe is his name, He says, I never doubt injuries. I never doubt honesty from players. Obviously, I've never had a situation like this where one of his players is under investigation. So that's the gist of it. And the Shohei Ohtani thing, I mean, it's different. But I'm sure my point is, I think Major League Baseball, they know about some of this. And I'm sure now they know about, like, a lot more of it. Because of Shohei's stance, which obviously he is basically taking the stance that they were the victim of theft, that Mizuhara, his former interpreter, just stole the money, and that he, you know, basically didn't know anything about it, had no knowledge of the bookie, had no knowledge that he was gambling, and had no knowledge that Mizuhara had a gambling addiction. So that's his stance. So, and now we wait to hear the other side of it. But my point is, Major League Baseball probably won't. They probably will get the real story and facts, but I don't know if we'll ever hear them ourselves. I don't know if we'll ever get the truth from Major League Baseball. Well, they'll side with the Shohei Ohtani story. That's what's going to happen here.
Yeah. And I mean,
lock and step.
I don't know if he could. It's funny that, you know, how bad the Angels are. Is that all this has come out and not one person has said, well, clearly he was tanking the Angels last year, because that's just how bad the Angels are. We know they suck. So he couldn't have been fixing games for the Angels. But I hate the set press conferences where they say, they basically come out and say some things and you're still like, well, that doesn't answer. We still have some basic questions that we need you to figure out. Like, how did this guy steal $4.5 million from you? And nobody caught this. And it wasn't until the feds realized it. You were just never going to notice that $4.5 million was gone. That seems like a red flag. And
a lot of money.
And the fact that your interpreter had the ability to do that and get into your account and all, there's just pieces of how did this happen that people want to know. Hopefully that'll come out. But yeah, I agree. Other than that, you know, the far betting, I don't think too many people really don't believe Ohtani that he bet. They're just trying to figure out how does that happen? And if you just tell us, well, this is what happened, actually. You know, he has access to my laptop and he just logged into my account on my laptop and he went, oh, okay. Well, that makes more sense then. And, you know, you should fire your financial people today. You should fire all of them as well, because they should have caught what you were doing. But yeah, it's the NBA one is a little bit interesting. It's funny, because I was actually talking to a friend who we were looking at his props, because his numbers are just weird.
They are weird.
So I was talking to a friend about it, because he was like, well, he's, you know, he hits the under so often, but he also, like, he has spurts of good games, but that one feels too like it, that could have been also a trainer that's there that knows, hey, he's probably only going to play a couple minutes. Like, he doesn't want to sit in and play. The other note is that his brother is Michael Porter Jr., who plays for the Jr. Yeah. So it's not like his family needs the money necessarily.
No, I agree with that too.
So it's just a weird outing altogether.
I'm not saying he did anything, but my point was that's how deep they're like minority. They're like Minority Report when trying to investigate corruption now in gambling, because there's so much money in it that the only thing that can spoil it right now is the integrity of it. Like, if the integrity is somehow tainted that, oh no, actually there's corruption and there are players throwing games and there are players who are involved in, you know, kind of duplicitous activity when it comes to their play, and they're not genuinely competing because they're trying to, like I said, move some line or trying to influence some line of some sort or some prop bet of some sort. So that's the only thing that can hurt right now, that can slaughter this cash cow. That's so the casinos and the gambling companies and the gambling apps and the teams and the leagues and everybody, they are weeding it out. And it's, like I said, they are going to find out if you are gambling on a sport or if you're just gambling, period. They know it. And they just may not necessarily be able to get you, because you could have, you know, bets on other sports, or you may not be gambling on the facilities grounds, whatever it may be. But my point is that they are actively investigating as many players as they can and using as many of the resources as they can, as many of the brands, as many of the connections as they can to make sure that the sports are as corruption-free as possible when it comes to, you know, this type of, like I said, shady activity.
Yeah, well, I think in the NBA one too, it's when casinos and bookies and whatever else start to lose money. They immediately look and go, we don't lose money. This is a profitable industry for us. So if we're losing, someone's cheating because there's no way we're losing. And so it feels like that one too is just a flag that is not even much as AI as they went, hey, why are we losing money over here? Because either we're firing the line setters or this guy's cheating. Somewhere in there, something's happening because we're right about everyone else. And we don't lose money like this on anybody else.
I think you're right about that. I think they identify cheaters well because they're cheating. They're somehow, you know, I mean, they're looking. Yes, exactly. They're the ones rigging the system. So they're like, no, if you actually can beat the system, then you're cheating because we've rigged the system. And then they can't admit they rigged the system, which is why they identify cheaters really well. So, you're right on the money. That's exactly that. You just nailed it. All right, let's get to the we don't know what's going to happen with the Shohei Ohtani story now. Like I said, I think the investigation, I'm going to predict right now, as I did, that I guess the NBA would have a gambling, not a scandal, but at least they would have some type of issue concerning gambling to deal with. And that just happened yesterday. I'm going to predict that the investigation for Major League Baseball, no matter when it wraps up, it will basically align with Shohei Ohtani's story.
So, yeah. The only thing
there will be no dispute in what they find in Shohei Ohtani's story.
Yeah. The only thing that could end up being an issue is if the translator ends up getting like 20 years in jail.
Yes.
No, because if they give him a super long sentence, then he could be like, oh, no. I was told to be the fall man for this. And you were like, well, you maybe have to do like 6 months in like a white collar, super nice prison. And they're like, no, you're going to a bad prison for 20 years. He may say, wait, whoa, red flag. I'm a fall guy.
You might be right about that. Say right now, his side, Mizuhara's side, is the only, I think, thing that can blow up Shohei Ohtani's story, because the Major League Baseball investigation is not going to find anything that disputes what he's saying right now. But you're right. If Mizuhara decides, you know what, man, I don't care. I don't care. You know what? At this point, everybody's going down with me. I'm going down. Everybody's going down. But then he's got the integrity issue, because then it's his side against Shohei's side. And then ultimately he'll still end up going to jail. But at least the court of public opinion will probably be either split 50-50, believing that Shohei actually did have something to do with it. And then some people believe that Shohei didn't. Or I think most of the public will say, like I always do, you may not be guilty, but you're certainly not innocent.
Yeah.
I don't know if you're guilty, but you're not innocent. And I think Shohei is right there in that gray area. Not totally guilty.
Yeah.
But come on, man. You ain't innocent. I got best friends, and I wish I had access to their accounts. My man Channel's one of my best friends. I ain't got access to his account. You know what I mean? I ain't got access to Sim's account. I got access to none of my boys' account. They're my dogs. They ain't got access to my account, but I would trade any day with them. You know what I'm saying? But still, so that, how many, you got a best friend? Have they got access to your account?
Have
y'all
traded? No, nobody has access. No, that's the point. Okay. Now, granted, they're not stealing $4.5 million from me either. So they're ones trying to get into my account very much.
Yeah. But it's true. Good point. I'm just saying, like you said, there are a lot of questions about it right now. And he won't have to answer any at this point because, like I said, Major League Baseball, unless the other side disputes it, they'll align with whatever he's saying in terms of their investigation. All right. Good conversation. Let's get to this hip drop tackle discussion, because the NFL, they changed a lot of rules. We'll get to some of them, I think. Actually, some of them are really, really progressive, and I think in the best interest of the game. Tom Pelissero, he reported the NFL Competition Committee Chairman Rich McKay told him that the replay assistant would now be permitted to correct certain types of incorrect calls during the game, for like roughing the passer and intentional grounding. Say they got it wrong, you'd be like, "Nah, actually, y'all got, you know, we can we can actually jump in the time machine. We can, you know, tap the flux capacitor. We can jump in the DeLorean, and we can go back just a couple of plays, and we can get it right. So that's new. That is fantastic, and I like this. I like stuff like that. I think that's a step in the right direction. I think they've actually changed some of the rules about challenges as well. That if you win your challenges, you actually get an additional challenge. You don't they don't punish you if you just keep winning your challenge. So anyway, those are all kind of minor rule changes, but they are rule changes that have been less topical, because the hip drop tackle ban is probably right now the most debated of all the rule changes right now for the NFL. So if you don't know what the hip drop tackle is, basically the NFL defines it as when a foul is when a hip drop tackle foul is when a player uses his body weight to bring a runner to the ground by grabbing the runner with both hands or wrapping the runner with both arms and unweighting himself by swiveling and dropping his hips or lower body, landing on and trapping the runner's legs or below the knee. And you've seen examples. And by the way, Tony Pollard got hurt. That was an example of a hip drop tackle, which, like I said, it was legal until they just obviously decided that they're going to ban it. But he was a player that got injured as a result of that. Geno Smith recently, I remember his injury was a result of it. Mark Andrews this past season got hurt as a result of a hip drop tackle. I remember Delanie Walker had a career ending injury over the hip drop tackle. So the NFL is banning it because they're claiming it is 20 to 25 times more injuries happen, or at least that's a 20 to 25 times higher risk of injury with that particular tackling technique as opposed to other tackling techniques. That's what they claim. Rich McKay, who watched, he claims 20,000 tackles and documented and looked at how often what the injury rates were and how often injuries happen when each tackle technique was applied, and they came up with the data that the hip drop tackle increases injury risk by 20 to 25 times compared to other tackling techniques. That's why they unanimously banned it. There were no dissenting votes. It was a unanimous ban. And I have no problem with the NFL making the game safer. I think they should make the game safer so guys can play longer. Hell, I wish I could have played longer. And one of the things that took me out was a wedge on a kickoff, or at least that had one of my shoulder injuries, was a wedge on a kickoff, which was later banned. And I'm glad they banned it because it was ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like you just ran down there on a kamikaze mission to blow up the wedge and blow yourself up at the same time. Just made no sense at all. And they banned it. And so I have no problem with that. This is the problem that I think a lot of defenders in the NFL have with this and a lot of the rule changes, period. It's that a lot of the rule changes that are made are in the best interest of the safety of the game. 90% of them are disadvantageous to the defense. That's it.
Yeah,
that's what's going on. But you can't. How many rule changes can you think of that are in the interest of safety that are actually disadvantageous to the offense? Not many.
No, there's not a lot. Now.
It's like one or two.
Maybe something on the offensive line.
Yeah, maybe. About blocking.
Yeah,
like, you know what I mean? That kind of thing. Maybe that's about it.
Bringing people down, tackling guys in the offensive line. It's about everything
you can do. Remember, you can't have a cut block. Remember when you're engaged?
Yeah.
That's one of those, like, you can't
blocks in the back, I guess, and that kind of stuff. There's not a lot.
There's not a lot of them. So that's why the guys, the defenders in the NFL are upset. That's why the NFL Players Association is upset. They're like, okay, we get it. Rule changes to make the game safer. But there are things that offense, like, remember the targeting rule, and that everybody knows what targeting is. Using your helmet as a weapon, essentially, spearing a guy with it, especially helmet to helmet. That's specifically targeting. The offensive players do it too. Like, running backs often would lower their head, and then they would just use their helmet as a weapon, and they would make helmet-to-helmet contact with defenders, and they were the ones who were initiating that contact, never called targeting.
Yeah.
But by the letter of the law, that they are targeting, but basically officials have decided that only defenders can target, period. That offensive guys cannot target. And it's like, well, by the letter of the law, some of those running backs are targeting, but you'll never see an official call it. So in the NFL, the problem also with the NFL scoring is down. Scoring is, and that's also, I don't know if it's influencing this decision, but it is down across the board. And I do think ultimately there are a lot of decisions that are made to try to boost the offense. So I do think overall it is something that maybe even subconsciously, but it is something that I ultimately has been able to move some of the owners in a certain direction. And that's, you know, things slanted offensively for the game because they know they need more offense in the game. And for some reason, they haven't really been able to solve it. NFL scoring has decreased the last 3 years. Since COVID, NFL scoring has actually decreased. The games are competitive. The product is great. Games are competitive. The game is healthy. Got good young quarterbacks. But they're scoring fewer points. And that is freaking NFL owners out. Because they don't want low-scoring games.
No.
They know fans like points and fantasy football, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and I mean, we can go back and look at games that are 10-0 or 10-7, and you go, well, it's a close game. You're like, yeah, but that wasn't fun to watch. No one's paying to see punts. No one is paying to see that. And you know, even when you say what's great defense, you go, well, a lot of times it's just bad offense. And, you know, if you're missing passes by 7 yards, it doesn't matter who's guarding who. You're just missing the passes. But yeah, I think that for the rule change and stuff, that hip drop tackle needed to go. I get why people are upset about it, but it was one of those moves that it always looked super dangerous.
It does.
And the helmet to helmet ones, you get, okay, the physicality of the game where you're trying to go in and push somebody hard, but it wasn't even like it was a violent play. It just looked like it was dangerous. It was one of those plays. Every time you saw it, it looked really dangerous. So I don't have any problem with it being gone. I know they're trying to, it's going to be a weird rule change, and hopefully they can review things will be a part of it, because I know you can still do a hip drop, but you can't do a hip drop swivel. There's the wording of it.
They're going to call it anyway on you.
Yeah, they're going to call it either way.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can technically, if you hip drop them and don't fall on their legs, I think you're okay. But if you hip drop and spin and fall on the back of their legs, that is what the penalty is. Because they're trying, it's all the weird semantics that they try and normally not have, because they don't want to put the game in the referee's hands where it's a judgment call. And it feels like they were trying to figure out the fine line where players would not be as upset by letting it be a judgment call, but that never ends well, because basically both teams will always assume that the referee is making a favorable decision to the other team. You have to figure out ways to let the defense be competitive, but at the same point, you'll see defensive players that, you know, they'll make 7 bad tackles in a row, and on the 8th one, they'll have a case for it and then go, man, you're making the rules, so I can't win. And you're like, well, you did intentionally try and hurt a guy 7 times in a row. And on the 8th one, the guy ducked his head and it was a bad call. I think you can make caveats for fixing the ones where it blatantly wasn't the defender's fault, where a player lowers his head or a player does something last second and there's no way it's intent. There's no intent. And maybe don't find them as bad. You can still penalize them in the game, but don't find them as much. Because you say there was no intent to do this. This was simply an offensive player making a move at the last second. But other than that, you have to protect the players because fantasy football is one. But because when you're watching the games, it sucks when players are hurt. It sucks to watch football when, you know, even the Texans, when they were playing at the end of the season, when Nico Collins and Tank Dell and everybody's hurt on the offensive side for the Texans, it wasn't as much fun to watch the game. Because the offense is down because we don't have any wide receivers right now.
Yeah. No, you're right. And the NFL doesn't want their big money guys to get hurt.
Yeah. Oh, 100%.
So I can't never spend any money on these guys. We don't want them to get hurt too. So no, you're right about that. I agree with the rule change, but I also agree on the other side. If you go start looking at the overall tally of the rule changes over the last few years, there is a huge slant toward the offensive side of the ball. And the NFL, I went and found the numbers before we go to break here. The NFL is freaking out because scoring since COVID, and they kind of peaked at COVID, which was weird. The NFL thought, oh, man, COVID scoring might be down because, you know, they didn't have the crowds and all that kind of stuff, and scoring was actually up, and maybe that's why, because you didn't really have the crowds there and that kind of stuff. But they said they were at 49 points, like, combined, both teams combined, points per game during COVID. They went to 45. This is from the meetings that are going on right now because they're discussing it. They went to 45 in 2021. 43.7 in 2022, and they were down to 43.5 in 2023. And just, you know, like Patrick talked about, this is the number one TV show in America, and they want to make sure it's thriving, and they want to make sure it's entertaining. So if people have stuff to talk about, and if you're not scoring a lot of points, then, yeah, the narrative about the games would be like, it was boring. It was competitive, but it wasn't really fun to watch. And that's what they want. Young quarterbacks, too, by the way, that contributes to it, too. So the NFL will make the necessary adjustments to the rules to make sure the game stays entertaining. And by entertaining, I mean offensively. It'll be a game that is considered an offensive game. All right, we'll come back. We'll get into behind the burn-off curtain. We'll play some audio from Steve Sarkisian, his media availability after spring practice. He talked about the team and how it looks so far. We'll get into it and talk some Texas football on the other side right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming right back on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time to go behind the burnt orange curtain, talk some Texas football here. We'll have your big fat poll of the day coming up next segment. That will be an interesting conversation, I'm sure, that will be had on the text line. You can go there as well to participate in the show, 512-447-3776. But in the meantime, let's talk some Texas football. So, Sark, really excited about this year's team. You can tell from the way T talks about it. We'll get to a cut later on about the look of the team. And remember last year he said, and he was right, he said this team looks like a Sark team. They play like a Sark team. They run like a Sark team. He said even their attitude, it's more like my attitude. That's why I get along really good with all the players. And that team was a really good team. So we'll hear what Sark has to say when he's asked about, hey, what's the look of this team? This team looked like a Sark team, similar to last year. But first, there's a Sarkism that we got to get to. So Sark's got a new and I actually asked Coach Bob Shipley about this. So this is actually a coachism that's been out there for a while. Sark didn't invent this, but it is I've heard him use it before. So it is one of his favorite go-to coachisms where he talks about the thermostat and the thermometer. He wants guys to be he wants them to be a thermostat and not a thermometer. Here is Steve Sarkisian talking about his team.
Right. We use an analogy. You can be a thermostat or you can be a thermometer. And thermostats, they set the temperature, right? They bring the energy. They set the temperature. Thermometers, they just react to what is set. And so we need more guys that take the field with real intent. We need more guys that take the field with great energy so that the other players that may not know quite yet can fall in line with what that looks like.
I like that. Thermostat, thermometer. It's a good one. It ain't the last time you're going to hear it too. And we should get these start. Patrick, we need to start like collecting these because Vic Schaefer has a lot of great analogies. Yeah. He's got some damn good ones he throws out there. I actually have heard Jared Elliott use a couple too when I've heard him speak. He's a big coachism guy. I call him coachisms they throw out there. And see who on the 4 acres has the best coachisms. Does Rodney Terry have any? We got to start collecting these. Because I think Vic Schaefer right now may be the leader. But baseball coaches always – Augurito had started calling them Augie-isms.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they were – I mean, he's got – I think it's a book. I want to say somebody was, like, working on a book just of the Augie-isms and breaking them down as, like, from a philosophical perspective, which he was. He was kind of an everyday philosopher. But Augie-isms are a great example of it. I mean, he would drop one on you damn near every media availability. You'd get one from Augie. And they were analogies and metaphors. I call them coachisms because they could be a number of different things. But I'm glad, Sarks, that the best coaches, they collect them. They have a bunch of them that really summarize a point, so I ain't got to elaborate on it. I ain't got that kind of time, all right? Thermostat, thermometer. You get it? Boom. Simplified for you. There you go. That's what I'm talking about. All right, we'll start collecting those. I like that. I'm going to start keeping up with those. I'm going to start writing them down. Let my man Patrick start collecting them so we'll have them for the future. Little nuggets of wisdom from the coaches. All right, so he was asked after that, great coachism, which one of the players or who on the team right now is setting the tone? Who's setting the temperature out there? Who out there right now is a thermostat and not a thermometer? Here's what Sark had to say.
Yeah, no, I think naturally, I mean, I thought Alfred Collins looked really good today. Was very intentional with his approach. Baron Sorrell, Ethan Burke always bring it that way. But I think a couple new faces. I think Trey Moore brings it. That guy, he's wired right up front. I thought, Cedric Baxter and Jaden Blue again just kind of continue to assert themselves. And I'd be remiss if I didn't reference Trey Wisner. He's had a good, really, really good 4 days for us to start this thing off. So, again, it's hard to pinpoint everybody, but there's been some guys that have brought it for 4 straight days, and it's been impressive. And so hopefully – everybody can kind of fall in line with that so they know what it looks like.
Hey, wow. I got to tell you, the Trey Wisner shout out out of nowhere.
Yeah, I didn't get that
there
one.
There you go. But exactly. And there was one name this week, like, whoa, Trey Wisner, who you would thought in that running back room has, thought he'd been forgotten about or recruited over. Not the case, Patrick. Trey Wisner getting the shout out. So that running back room. So when he was asked about the guy setting the tone, he brought up both running backs, Cedric Baxter and Jaden Blue, and then brought up a sleeper, a dark horse in that room, and a Trey Wisner whoa. So the running back room, he's really happy with, and he's happy with the defensive end room, the edge room. He brought up Baron Sorrell. He brought up Ethan Burke. He said about Trey Moore. Yep. So he's got – he brought up three, and his, I think he named, what, seven players there total. But three, he basically – he had six players, three from each were from a different position room. And I think that bodes well. We know the running back room has a really good culture, Patrick. They have for years, and Tashard Trust has kept that going even with Bijan, even before Bijan. Sam Drayton was doing a great job that room. That's why he ended up getting a head coaching job. So that room has had an A-plus culture. Now you're sending multiple guys to the combine back-to-back years. It's had an A-plus culture for, you know, about 4 or 5 years now going on. So it's been really good. And you go look at the defensive end room, the edge position, that's where you expected to make the leap this year, especially, and we didn't even talk about a young Colin Simmons, but that's a young guy you're bringing in. You got Justice Finkley also being a part of that group. I think that bodes well for those two positions.
Yeah, I mean, if you talk about, you know, the production that Texas has had on the D-line, not necessarily defensive ends, but in the D-line, that culture has been really good, and Byron Murphy and Tavondre Sweat were part of that culture last year, and then the running back room has been growing. But yeah, I love hearing the Trey Wisner name just because we hear that coming in. What have you done during the offseason? How much are you ready mentally and physically to come in and compete for a job in a very difficult place to compete? You know, they're bringing in new guys. You know that you may not be the starter, but how much are you competing? How much are you competing to be on special teams? How much are you competing to be on the field as much as you can be and ready to do it? And I think that's why, you know, you get a shout out for that, because he walks in and goes, this guy has every reason to just show up to practice and do what he's supposed to do and move on, but he's trying to be part of something bigger. And when you have those guys on every aspect, and you know, Keelan Robinson was a big piece of that last year, going and doing stuff on special teams. I don't know if Wisner will be on special teams or not.
He made plays last year on special teams.
And so if you have guys like that that are leading the way on all three phases and not just your offensive leaders and your defensive leaders, if you then have special teams leaders as well, that's a way to really take an edge when you're talking about playing a full football game.
Yeah, no, you're right, because Rojo, remember, Rojo was big on special teams in addition to his contributions on offense. And, yeah, I mean, like I said, that's – if you're Trey Wisner, you got to love that Sark gave you that shout-out there, along with the starting running backs. Also goes to the conversation we had yesterday about the pony package. The two tailback sets, you got a lot of talent at running back now. You saw about C.J. Baxter, Jaden Blue, but also Trey Wisner. I've heard Christian Clark and Jared Gibson. Those young guys look really good already, at least physically. They just look like they're already really mature physically.
Yeah, I saw that. I saw a picture of Christian Clark yesterday. Dude, that does not look like a freshman.
You see him thighs?
Yeah, like, does not look like a freshman.
Dude, you had thighs like that in high school? Like, what the hell?
I'll tell you, that's crazy. Have you ever seen pictures of Nick Chubb in high school?
I could imagine though. Yeah,
Nick Chubb. What? There's a picture of him running track in high school, and I have seen this video.
And yeah. He's next to a little white dude. Yeah. Yes, I have seen that. Yes, and they're like stretching next to each other, getting ready to run. You're like, what the hell? This is crazy. Yes,
right, whose dad's running this race?
Yes, no, he looks like a grown man out there in his mid 20s, getting ready to run against some high school sophomore.
Yeah,
but you're right. Some guys, their bodies are built different, you know, and. Yeah, I mean, they got a couple. Jared Gibson, his upper body is just built like I said, it's built like a grown man. So that's the running back room getting a lot of love as well. They should, but I'm glad that edge room we've been talking about, we've been hyping them up. Baron Sorrell, Ethan Burke. And I give a shout out to Alfred Collins. He said Alfred Collins first. And we expect Alfred Collins to make a leap similar to what Byron Murphy and Tavondre Sweat did before them. You talked about the culture of that that defensive line room. But before that, it was more Ojemo and Keandre Colburn. That's what you'd like to see. You like to see every year. All right. You just it's not, you know, if it's who it's going
to
step up.
And you like to hear this year with Bo Davis not being there anymore. Kenny Wright coming in. Okay. Yeah. Is this D-line still going to be able to have the right attitude and right coach? You know, because you just wonder, you know, anytime you bring in something new to an equation, what does that matter? And when you hear that the D-line's doing great, that's good for Kenny. And when you hear that Trey Moore's coming in and doing great, those are both good pieces that you're bringing in positive additions to the team.
Yeah, no. Kenny Baker was his energy. They say he's already the funniest guy out at practice. Like, he's the one that's cracking a lot of jokes. Got energy. You want that young energy in your. You want a nice, healthy mix on your coaching staff between the wisdom of the old coach and the energy of the new coach. And that, and it's a balance. You don't want too many. You don't want too much old wisdom. All right, because then that, I think, can also work against you. And, you know, I don't think you want too many young coaches on your staff either, because that's too much inexperience. And then you got the growing pains. You learn on the fly. You get that healthy mix in there, and when you get it right, it can be a really, really great coach staff. And I think Sark is – I think he's cognizant of that. I do. I think he's someone that's mindful of it. Okay, one last cut before we get to the break. We got time for this. Let's get to the cut when Sark's asked about, does this team – does it feel like a Sark team? Right. What does his team look like? Does it feel like a Sark team? I like this answer. Here's Steve Sarkisian.
Yeah, I think we have a great looking team. I think we have really good length, even at our, you know, at our skill position spots. We've got good length. We've got good speed. I think we have good size internally. I think we've got quarterbacks that can make the throws necessary. I think we got versatile players at positions where you need versatility, whether it's tight end, linebacker, safety, star. The runners are all versatile players. They can catch, they can run, they can run with speed, they can run with power. And so I think it's been very intentional now going into year four of the what we're looking for specifically at position groups, how we tried to build this team. And I think it's coming to fruition. Every year you look a little bit different here or there, right? But for the most part, when we come out and I look at our team warm up and I watch a stretch and I watch some of the individual drills when I'm not with the quarterbacks, and we're a good looking team, but we need to play good, right? That's always the challenge. But to your point, I do. It looks like a team that I recruited, and not only physically, but I think the mental makeup as well.
And the mental makeup, obviously, I think Sark talks about how he likes competitors, guys that compete at everything. Look at the example of Xavier Worthy at the combine, runs the 4.25 and decides, no, I want to break the damn record. I could do it. He likes guys on his team who will have that competitive sickness with them. But I love the traits he described. And he mentioned the intentional roster construction with these traits in mind. Length. First thing he mentioned was length. Second thing he mentioned was speed. Third thing he mentioned was size. Then he said, we got quarterbacks that can throw it. And the fourth trade he mentioned was versatility. Fourth trade he mentioned was versatility. He talked about quarterbacks. So it was the fifth thing that he mentioned there. But length, speed, size, and versatility, and, of course, quarterbacks. And I think all of those are traits that you can't coach. So you need to recruit them. You need to acquire them. You can't coach length.
Yeah.
You can't coach speed. You can't coach size. Versatility, I think, is programmed really early on in an athlete's kind of skill set in their athletic profile is really early on. So I think if you did it and played a lot of positions as a young player, then that translates as you get older. But for the most part, that is something I think also that you need to acquire, and that you can't really coach versatility. And then he talked about quarterbacks because, yeah, you got to make sure that he has – that's the most important and most valuable position. Also, the toughest to evaluate and the toughest to develop and project. So he's like, no, I got to make sure we got the right quarterbacks, high-level guys. So that's what he's built the roster with, those specific ideas in mind. And you can tell that it's paying off for him. That's why the team looks the way it does. And even out there in practice, it's faster, they're longer, they're bigger, and they're just better overall athletes and football players than you have had in recent years.
Yeah, and it's funny because you can kind of tell the difference of when he answers the question, he has to go to the positive place in it. Because I think there is he doesn't necessarily have the same trust in this team he had in last year's team, just because there was way more players offensively that he felt he could trust. He knew what they could do in games. He knew better. So this one, I think he may like the depth of it, the talent in it, the length, the physical abilities. But if you can add in the trust, if they earn that trust throughout the season by continuing to bring that culture, continuing to work at the rate that he wants them to work, and then also being able to make big plays, do what he wants them to do, then you'll really see this go into not just the look of a Sark team, but the feel of a Sark team too. And that's how you get to that next level. that obsession that he talks about to getting to winning it all.
Yeah, that's why at the end, good point. He says, they got to play good, though. They look good. They got to play good.
Exactly.
All right, we come back. We'll have the big fat poll of the day. And my man Patrick will get us started with the musically themed day of the week. I always have fun with that. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn. Rod Davis coming right back on the horn.
Back on the Rodcast on a Tuesday morning. It is a top of the charts Tuesday here on the Horn. That means that we play songs that reached number one this day in history, and kicking it off with the Turtles. Do a little Happy Together for you, kicking it off on a Tuesday morning. It is time for the Big Fat Poll today. The text line is open. 512-447-3776 is the text line number.
Patrick's Big Fat Poll of the Day on the Horn.
Big Fat Poll of the Day today. We just talked about that defensive ends, the edge room for the Longhorns. And so it leads us to our question. There seems to be an easy answer, but you could go off of it. Who will lead the Longhorns in sacks next season? Who do you have leading the Longhorns in sacks? Now, Trey Moore is going to be your front runner in this. Trey Moore's got the experience. He is going to be somebody that could come in and be a big impact player for the Longhorns. You could say it's a young man that Colin Simmons is going to come in, get in there, be able to come in and be put in situations advantageous for him, mostly going to be used in that rushing situation where Trey Moore is going to be more of an every down back, probably going to get double teamed a bit more and trying to stop Trey Moore until an Alfred Collins or somebody else can start to demand a double team themselves. Trey Moore is going to be the main guy they're going to focus on coming at the quarterback. So maybe it would be somebody else like a Colin Simmons. Maybe it's Ethan Burke. Maybe he favors the fact that Trey Moore is on the other end of the line and Ethan Burke comes in and picks up those sacks. Or we could go to the linebacking core and say Anthony Hill on some exotic blitzes this year comes in and gets some big sacks. But that is the question of the day. Who will lead the Longhorns in sacks next season? You got somebody else. If you think of Baron Sorrell might sneak into that conversation, maybe having a good year. Who do you have with the Longhorns having the most sacks next season?
That is a good question. I think right now I'm going to go with Ethan Burke probably, just because he's going to play, I think, as much, if not more, than any of the other edge rushers. They'll rotate guys. And he does have some natural pass rushing ability. I think he led the team in sacks last season.
I believe so, yes.
Right now he's my pick, and I love the way they use him. Sometimes he's up in a 2-point stance, sometimes he's down in a 3-point stance. They actually do move him around just a little bit. The Anthony Hill one is good. I think Sark even said that he's their best natural pass rusher on the team right now. But I don't know how often they're gonna put him on the edge. Matter of fact, we have an audio cut we'll play later on of Sark being asked about Anthony Hill where he's gonna align on the team. But they can only put him on the edge if they find another linebacker they trust.
Yeah,
to play at linebacker and stabilize the middle of the field and the core or the central nervous system of the defense. So that's maybe my concern there. I think if I just go off who I think is the best pass rusher, it's Anthony Hill. But how often is he going to be on the edge is the question. Just situationally, I'm assuming. And Ethan Burke will get – he's a mechanic. He's like, because he's so blue collar. He gets a lot of sacks just from pure effort. And you know what I mean, and his motor.
Yeah,
and that's, in addition to the same situation.
And that's again, I say Trey Moore is going to have a really good season. But if they double team on him and they focus on him, and you put Ethan Burke on the other side, that could be a really good 1-2 punch where Ethan Burke comes out a little bit ahead in that at the end of the season, just because you know if you're putting a single coverage on Ethan Burke all season, and that running back's looking the other direction, and whoever else and all that protection, you can sneak in there a few times.
Yeah, I've heard Trey Moore, though, he doesn't look the part. He didn't look like the other defensive ends because Baron Sorrell transformed his body. Ethan Burke's long and rangy, looks like an NFL defensive end. Colin Simmons coming in. I mean, he's a typical freak. But Trey Moore is your best natural, edge rusher. I said, obviously, Anthony Hill is the guy they move around. But in terms of the guys who are defensive ends in the edge room, he is fantastic. His BGO ball get off, his first step is fantastic. He's explosive.
Yeah, and he's got the resume.
He's already done it. Yeah, at a high level. I think he can, and that's the question. Can he do it at a higher level? And how often is he gonna rotate? I gotta see that defensive end rotation. That's gonna be really fun. And that'll go a long ways determining your question too.
Yep.
Who's out there the most to get the most opportunities?
We could see Colton Vosick start to get into that rotation a little bit as
great
well.
Great point, too. Yeah, exactly. Right. How deep is that room? How deep is that that rotation? All right. Good stuff there. I love the big fat poll today. Always an interesting conversation. We'll come back on the other side. We'll have a conversation about the Cowboys. There's some Texans talk as well that we'll get into. And Raj, around the day, the Shedeur Sanders comment, if you have not heard it, we'll play it for you. And apparently there are some people who took offense to this comment. We'll get to that. But I will break it down and psychoanalyze Shedeur Sanders and tell you exactly what's going on. All right, we'll do that coming up on the other side in Rod's rant of the day. So a lot to get into on the show. Come right back. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Davis coming right back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Let's talk about the city of Austin. Other than the traffic, it is one of the best cities in the country. But the reason for the traffic is people keep moving here. They know that it's an awesome city. And as the city continues to grow and thrive, so do our friends over at Ironworkers Local Union 482. Many of the iconic landmarks that we love in this city were created and built by the skilled craftsmanship of Ironworkers Local Union 482, like the Pennybacker Bridge and DKR Stadium. And the folks over at Ironworkers Local Union 482 right now are engaged in another project, a big project right here in Central Texas, helping once again that our community grow. They're hiring over 3,000 people for a big project. And right now they're offering competitive wages, competitive benefits, and the pension plan, even offering training for unskilled labor through their apprenticeship program. So become a member of Ironworkers Local 482 and take pride in the type of teamwork and craftsmanship that helps shape the future of our great city. You can maximize your potential and accept the challenge of becoming the best version of yourself. Right now, if you're looking for in new employment opportunities or a refreshing career change, it's a perfect opportunity for you to look up our friends over at Ironworkers Local Union 482. Right now online, you can go inquire about these opportunities, learn more about them at ironworkers482.org. That's ironworkers482.org. All right. Welcome back to the Rodcast. It is a Top of the Charts Tuesday. Thanks to my friend and co-host, Patrick Davis, the Idealionaire, coming up at all the great musically themed days of the week. That's when he plays a jam that reached the top of the Billboard charts on this day in history. And we always have a great time with it. It is my favorite musically themed day of the week. I always learn a lot. And actually, I learned even last hour when you introduced Top of the Charts Tuesday. It was the Turtles. I know the Turtles sung that song. That's one. That's a great song.
Happy Together.
I'm assuming one hit wonder there because I've never.
I don't know if they were fully one hit wonder. I think they had other like singles and stuff. It was definitely their biggest hit.
All right, the Turtles. I had never heard of the Turtles before, but there you go. But I love the song, no doubt about it. Okay, I was distracted because I was. We'll get to some Cowboys discussion, Texans discussion, Shedeur Sanders comments, which offended basically the entire high school football coaching world, and it's really funny because he went to a private school, so the comment that he made was about 6A Texas high school football. I'm gonna say it was disrespectful, but people took offense to his comments. So we'll play that coming up in Rod's rant and discuss whether it was indeed offensive. We got your Horn headlines that'll be coming up here momentarily, but there's a TMZ story that's a weird story I was following, and it just came across my timeline that they saying VY got into a bar fight. I guess I love how TMZ is so reliable. Like, man, TMZ, they got it. They got video of it. And they claimed that VY was involved in a wild bar fight last month that ended. This is in H-Town at Tokyo Joe's Shot Bar in Houston around 9 p.m. In the footage, you can see VY wearing a white hat, black shirt, and shorts. And he starts arguing with the man. It's about a two-minute video. But toward the end of the video, some dude sucker punches VY. And it puts him down. Like, it took him out. Like, he definitely sucker punched him. Because like, the dude kind of comes out of nowhere. I don't know if him and VY were actually, if they were the ones in an argument. It's hard. There's a lot going on. There's a lot of people. I don't know if you got a chance to watch the video. Because it goes from one side of the bar to the other side of the bar. And then punches start being thrown. And then this dude hits VY with a haymaker. And sends him to the floor. VY's big.
Yeah.
And this dude, he wasn't as big as VY, but he hit him with a haymaker. It did look like a sucker punch. VY did not see it coming. It looked like VY was, this tension was diverted elsewhere, that he was focusing elsewhere, and then the dude just hit him with it. They say HPD was called to the scene, and the bar's called out to the scene by the bar's owner, who claimed he was the one who was hit by a drink and an elbow. Apparently got started by somebody throwing a drink. I'm not sure. And the cops say the man told them that the tiff all started over a conversation about race and turned physical once he asked the patrons to leave. We're told, however, the man ultimately didn't want to press charges and no arrests were made.
Wow.
There you go. But it's up on TMZ. Posted like, I don't know, 4 hours ago. It's
come on, Vince. You got to stay out of trouble. Vince,
well, I mean, like I said, I don't know the genesis of it, how it all started, instigated what. That's a wild story. Sorry, I just came across my timeline. I was like, well, that's weird. But it do, like I said, he got sucker punched. My man VY can throw them hands. I know VY. Well, I know he still can, but you shouldn't be trying to throw hands. But if I don't, like I said, I don't know what happened and who started what. But there you go. That's TMZ worthy stuff going on. All right. We'll get back to that. Wasn't even off the record, but it was kind of off the record. But we'll get back to some Texas football conversation, actually. Not about guys getting in bar fights, but about Texas spring football. We'll do that coming up next segment. We'll get to some of that Sark RDO. That was a lot of it. We didn't get to all of it. So we'll get back to some of that. But in the meantime, let's hit the Horn headlines. Then let's come back. Let's talk Dallas Cowboys on the other side, because Cowboys fans are growing more and more frustrated with their Cowboys. And this time, Mike McCarthy has something to say about the Cowboys in free agency. We'll hear those comments. But first, let's hear from my man Patrick, getting us educated and informed about the Horn headlines of the day.
All right, your Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. The Texas women's basketball Sweet 16 matchup has been set. Gonzaga was able to handle Utah 77-66, outpacing Alyssa Pilley's 35 points to advance. Texas will take on the 4-seeded Gonzaga on Friday night in Portland. In the NBA, all three Texas teams were in action. Dallas Mavericks topped the Jazz 115-105 with help from another Luka Doncic triple-double. With the help of the Spurs beating the Suns 104-102 in a game where Wembanyama did not play, the Mavericks move into a tie for the sixth seed with the Kings, who they will play tonight. And the Rockets were able to move within a half game of the 10 seed with a 110-92 win over the Portland Trailblazers. Jalen Green continued his hot scoring with 20 of his 27 points in the game in the second half. The Longhorn baseball team will close out a 10-game homestand tonight against Texas A&M Corpus Christi, where a freshman Cole Selvig will be the probable starter. Texas is 25-5 all-time against the Islanders, winning in their last five matchups, and that is your Horn headlines.
All right, thank you, Patrick, for the Horn headlines. We appreciate that. Let's get to some of this Cowboys discussion. If we have time, we'll talk Texans. If not, we can table that discussion until later on in the show at 9 o'clock. But let's get to this Cowboys talk because Mike McCarthy, he sat down with Adam Schefter, I believe it was. Adam Schefter talked to Mike McCarthy, had an interview with him, and one of the things that he asked Mike McCarthy about was NFL free agency, what the Cowboys are doing about free agency. How does he feel about free agency? The answer might be frustrating for Cowboys fans, but here's what Mike McCarthy had to say about the Cowboys and their free agency approach this offseason.
I'm a big believer in a second and third year jump. You know, we have some young players. We got some guys coming back off of IR that were young players that we're excited about. So we are definitely improving. You know, we're just not part of the free agent market right now.
So is that what Cowboys fans can hang their hat on, the fact that there are guys coming back that are going to be getting better because people keep waiting for the Cowboys to make moves?
Well, I think that, and also it's, I mean, there's a lot left. So I mean, it's, you know, you'll probably have a market right before the draft or post draft, and then you got your June 1st market, and you know, obviously we'll have another draft class, so I have great confidence in our roster.
All right, yeah, essentially we have confidence in our roster is another way of saying we like our guys. Right. That's the quote, the Cowboys, that's kind of rings true to Cowboys fans. We like our guys. And what is even more disturbing about this particular talent acquisition cycle is they really haven't re-signed their own guys. Dak, Micah Parsons, CeeDee Lamb. That hasn't happened either. But here's a number that'll frustrate you, because I've been doing some research about the Cowboys and just the weird financial state that they're in, salary cap wise, even as an organization. And I've pointed this out several times, and I've been collecting these from credible sources like Over the Cap and Spot Track. I mean, you know, these are credible sources. Andrew Brandt, you know, people that keep up with the NFL salary cap and those teams. And I've pointed this out before. So the Cowboys have the fourth lowest payroll in the NFL currently right now, according to Over the Cap. So fourth lowest payroll. They have the least amount of cap space of any team in the NFL. That was even the case at the start of the new calendar year. According to my man Bobby Belt, if you look at free agents, extensions, waivers, and trades, the Cowboys' total spending this year, $11.1 million. Is the last in the NFL, but the second to last team in total spending this calendar year has been the Chargers, who are at $39.2 million. So that's how far removed they are from that team. Think about it. And the Saints are the third. They are third. They have the third lowest in total spending in the NFL, at least in this new calendar year. The Saints were in cap hell and are currently $62 million over the projected 2025 cap. Dallas is under that cap, and they're under that projected cap by a lot. And they still spent almost five times more than Dallas.
Crazy.
Even though the Cowboys – yeah, it's crazy. And the Cowboys right now, they have the third most expensive offense in 2024 currently. And so they're not spending much on that will change when Micah Parsons is paid his big money, gets his big money deal. That'll change when hell, if they play Deron Bland, that's going to change too. But there's just some weird, I don't know, the irregularities, this strange, if you will, kind of cash numbers and total. If you look at the transactions and the cash over cap with the Cowboys and where they are in terms of their salary cap, room and salary cap space, it doesn't really add up in terms of how much they're spending and how much cap space they actually have. So yeah, they're in a very strange place that not a lot of teams in the NFL are in. And I'm not saying that they have a lot of options and they have a lot of room to work in terms of the salary cap. I'm just saying I don't know how they got here because like I said, a lot of the numbers, like having the lowest payroll, one of the lowest payrolls in the NFL, and the total spending, it doesn't necessarily add up to the methods of the Cowboys in terms of their talent acquisition.
Yeah, and I know that they've restructured a lot of guys on that roster, and you know, basically a lot of this restructuring is we'll write you a check right now, and then that money will go on later on in your contract and stuff like that, where and so they'll have stuff where they've already paid, so you know, they're not necessarily have to pay this money anymore, but it's going to sit on their salary cap for a while. And they've done that enough times that they're kind of stuck with some of the contract that they're trying to work out. I mean, they still have money on the book for Zeke. They are still paying Dak Prescott, or still have him on the books for at least another two seasons after this. Even if he were to leave, his dead cap numbers are there because of restructures he's done that they keep trying to build and build. And it feels partially like this season, they have just said, screw it. We're not going to go. We did it. We tried. And it never got closer. We weren't getting any closer spending money. So we'll just go out and put everybody in a contract here. And we feel we still have the people here to do it. We paid enough to get the people here. So now you guys just have to perform for us, or we're letting everybody go. And we're starting over. And I can't imagine they're going to let Dak go. I can't imagine they're going to let CeeDee Lamb go. I can't imagine they're going to let Micah Parsons go. But it does feel like they are really up against it in this. And Mike McCarthy has never been a guy who really seems like he's much in the player personnel decisions.
No.
Which I think is kind of also in that Green Bay frame of mind, that in Green Bay, the player that, you know, they don't really necessarily have the coaches as involved in player selections. And he just doesn't seem that. So when he says that, that's a Jerry Jones line. He's just repeating what Jerry Jones has told him. Mike McCarthy just comes out and says, roster. He goes, no, I think we're going to be really good next year because we have these guys. And you go, yeah, but you had holes last year, and you didn't address them last year, and it cost you, and now you're not addressing them again this year. How do you expect that to be better? I don't understand how you expect to win and improve in areas that you were deficient in last year without bringing anybody new in and just hoping for the best again, and just that Cowboys hope.
Hope is not a strategy.
No.
Yeah. No. And for the Cowboys, here's some more like troubling numbers, I guess, if you're a Cowboys fan. Because Andrew Brandt, former VP of the Packers, you just brought the Packers, right? The Packers are one of the most organized, well-run franchises in all of sports. He says, listen, cash is what a player will actually receive in a contract. He said the cap is just a mechanism of compliance, a way of NFL teams, basically an accounting mechanism for teams for contracts and to determine life of the deals. He said, and through the NFL's, you know, signing and options of prorating and spreading out contracts, backloading and front loading them, and the cash over cap, cap adjusted ways of you to get kind of short-term gains, but you would have to pay kind of long-term pain for that, right? Short-term gains, long-term pain. That's that window we're talking about in the NFL, the five-year window. And he says, in analyzing a player contract or a team payroll, many fans get caught up in the salary cap hits. He said, don't do that at all. Just only pay attention to the cash. Don't get distracted. He said, everything else is a fugazi. The cash is what matters. How much cash are the team spending? Because they're obligated to spend a certain amount of cash.
Yeah.
Based on the CBA, individually, each team has to spend 89% of the league salary cap in cash over 2 4-year periods, 2013 to 2016, 2017 to 2020. And that was upped actually to 90% over the 2021-2023 seasons, that 23 period. That was in the CBA. So it's already stated that no, we essentially got a floor here and you got to spend a certain amount of money. Because we're not going to allow you to be a cheap billionaire in this league. And combined, the 32 NFL teams must spend 95% of the league salary cap in cash each year, giving them, once again, a floor, like, y'all got to spend this damn money, all right? Yeah. Y'all can't be cheap. If you go look at the cash spent, we're talking about cash here, what Andrew Brandt says, pay attention to the straight cash, homie. The Cowboys rank just 25th in the NFL over the 4-year period from 2013 to 2016 in cash spent in that time period, actual cash spending. The Eagles ranked first in that time period. $22 million more in cash spending than the Cowboys over that 4-year period. From 2016 to 2019, Jason Lockenfor of CBS Sports, he claims in his study that he did that the Cowboys as a team spent the least cash over that period as well. $634 million versus a league average of $703 million. So you're spending below the average in cash. More, I think, probably more to the point for Cowboys fans, the Eagles were identified as one of the top five teams in spending cash in that time period. And Patrick, you've talked about this, your cash over cap take that you've always had about, hey, cash over cap gives you an advantage, which it does because the NFL CBA basically gives you a discount. Everybody gives you a discount for paying cash. You want to go buy a house? You want to go buy a car? You pay cash? They'd be like, oh, yeah, man, I'll give you a discount. We ain't got to deal with these fees. We ain't got to deal with none of that. Give me cash up front. Let's get this thing done. So essentially, the NFL CBA is built the same way. You want to pay cash for a player, you get a discount on that player. And so from 20, I would say the COVID year was weird, hard to find information on COVID year 2020, strange. But from 2021 to 2023, the Cowboys over the last 3 years, the Cowboys ranked 30th in cash spending in that time period. So the Cowboys, whether you like it or not, this is why they call Stephen Jones Catboy. Over the last decade, they've ranked 25th in cash spending from 2013 to 2016, last in cash spending from 2016 to 2019, and 30th in cash spending from 2021 to 2023. They don't spend the straight cash, homie. Now, if you look at it, they build through the draft. So they are the most homegrown team in the NFL. That's the cheapest way to acquire labor in the NFL, other than undrafted free agents, which, you know, the Cowboys are really good at that too, by the way. So part of their problem is the reason they're in this salary cap situation is that they don't like spending cash. They have the cash. Jerry Jones got cash, but you got to be somewhat liquid. And Jerry Jones has liquid cash to spend, but he doesn't want, I guess, that discount that you get with building these contracts with a lot of cash spending in them, instead of prorating them for longer term deals over a longer period of time, and they end up with all the dead money on the cap. As you pointed out, especially when players underperform those contracts.
Yeah, I mean, there has to be a reason behind it. And I know Jerry will never tell you why he's not going to be the cash guy, why he wouldn't take the easier option that it seems like, you know, you have the money to do. He built the AT&T Stadium in Arlington as kind of a show of how much money he had to be able to do the kinds of things he wanted to do. And he's been able to put together the star in Frisco and all this other stuff. But for when it comes to investing in his team, just for whatever reason, he has never believed that was the way to do it. And it feels like it's been a disadvantage at points where you could have brought in, you know, two or three guys. It's not like you have to be number one in this category, but you probably don't want to be last.
Yeah, no, and listen, you're close. I mean, all you want to do is get to the NFC title game and then eventually play for a Super Bowl, and you have more all pros on your team than anybody else. So you have drafted really well as any team in the league, but you should use every advantage possible to push you over the top. And it's clear this is an advantage the Cowboys don't like to use. They just not, well, we don't go there. That's not how we operate. And you could argue that's one of the things that's holding them back. That's limiting them as, you know, a football organization, because they don't explore every advantage to improve the organization, to improve the team. This is an advantage that they just won't. I don't know why they're not into it. I'm sure there's a good business reason. And Cowboys, I mean, they're a great business. But in terms of winning championships, they haven't been able to do that. And I think one of the reasons is this, a microcosm of it. They don't explore every opportunity to improve. They don't.
Yeah, no, they try and find the most cost-effective way to do everything, but that sometimes you have to reach out. And now, we'll see. if they end up at the end of this offseason and they go and, you know, trade for a running back, they re-sign Dak, they re-sign CeeDee Lamb, they re-sign Micah Parsons, then none of us can say that they didn't spend money, because all that is going to cost them a little bit.
Yeah.
But
no, you're right about that.
If they don't address the defensive tackle position, they don't address offensive line, and except for the draft, they don't address the running back position again. They don't re-sign at least two of them. Then I think you really have to start to wonder, what is their plan going into this? And is this not so much the trend that they have never really been spending much money? And is this a outlier of a season that they really are just fed up with the lack of progression of success, where they've gotten to the same point over and over, but haven't been able to get over that hill and want to change things up?
Yeah, no, that's a good point. All right, you know what, we're going to push Rod's rant to the next segment, because I do want to get in that Sark audio. So we'll be quick. We'll play that Shedeur Sanders sound. Then I'll tell you exactly what I think is. I'll psychoanalyze Shedeur Sanders. I'll tell you what I think is going on. But we also know that a lot of folks took offense to what he said. So we'll discuss that. We'll also get into some more Sark audio. He spoke to the media after yesterday's spring practice. So we're going to talk some Texas football. We'll talk a little college football on the other side, right here on Rod's Rant, right here on the Rodcast. Rod's Rant coming up next segment. I'm my man Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Lohorn. Rod Babers coming right back on the horn. All right. Welcome back to the Rodcast. Time for Rod's rant of the day. Let's hear from Shadur Sanders before we get into some of this Sark sound here. Shadur Sanders spoke on, I guess, being an underdog. And I don't know how Shadur Sanders is an underdog right now, but he talked about how dealing with disrespect and people counting him out his entire football career. And then either knowingly or unknowingly, he took a shot at big boy football in the state of Texas. Here is Shadur Sanders, the starting quarterback at the University of Colorado, also the son, of course, of Hall of Famer Deion Sanders.
I came from a private school, so at the end of the day, I dealt with a lot of negativity, a lot of hate, a lot of everything I done dealt with already year after year. I came from a small private school. All the other kids was going big, you know, Power Five, and they went to big 6A, Texas 6A schools and stuff. I don't see those same kids around. I don't see them excelling in their programs or whatever they're doing. So I've always been against the odds, like, in different ways.
Okay, so people got upset because he said, I don't see those guys around. I don't see the other 6A Texas high school players, you know, playing at the highest levels. And he's mistaken about that. He's right and he's wrong. He's wrong because there are plenty of great players that came from 6A Texas high school football programs that are competing at the highest levels. I mean, you can go through it, right? Quinn Ewers just played in the college football playoff. Jalen Miro just did too. Those guys, I believe, were ranked in the same, you know, you look at the quarterback class, they were right in the same category with Shadur Sanders, right? That's, they came out around the same time. Those guys played 6A high school football. Now, I will say that he was not ranked really high. You go look at the quarterbacks that were ranked ahead of him in Texas at the time. I'm not a recruiting Nick or an analyst, but I mean, Quinn Ewers was probably the top, Jalen Miro. But then guys like Garrett Nussmeier and Preston Stone and Sawyer Robertson and Baron Martin, like, he was not a highly rated or highly recruited guy. He even talks about how he went to one of his, and this is what I think is kind of at the heart of it. And there've been six NFL first team all pros who I think went to 6A Texas high schools per CBS, they threw that out there too. So plenty of great players come out of 6A programs that have represented, played in the college football playoff and are still representing. But this shows me, like a lot of great athletes, and Shadur Sanders is a really good quarterback. I mean, he's going to be a first round pick, and there's a chance he could end up being the top quarterback drafted. I mean, he's got that kind of ability. He's putting together that kind of resume. He's got some things to work on, but that's a different discussion. Like a lot of great athletes, they have to sharpen the chip on their shoulder. They, you know, because some of them, like guys like MJ, is part of this too, right? We talked about this with Tom Brady and how it's annoying with guys like Tom Brady, how psychologically they need to flip the script and turn themselves into an underdog, even though they're not actually an underdog. And it's like, MJ, why is MJ still trying to be an underdog in his Hall of Fame speech? Yeah, I was counted out. And it's like, no, you're a great athlete. You matured a little later than some of your peers, but you end up being one of the best athletes on the planet. And you made a really good case for Tom Brady, and he still plays the underdog card. You're like, dude, he went to Michigan. It's like,
he started at Michigan at points.
Yeah, it wasn't at North Texas or anything. Like, he was drafted. Yeah, nothing against North Texas, but you get my point. There are levels to this. And that's a good point. But Shadur Sanders, he's got a good case for it because he started at HBCU, which I think he's more following his dad. I'm sure he probably could have gotten an offer to play somewhere else if he wanted to, but he played in HBCU, which is a lower level of competitive football in college, and he believes he wasn't highly recruited. Remember, he throws out the story about, I believe it is Kendall Browse, actually, that was a camp he went to as a kid, and Kendall Browse didn't show him a lot of love, didn't give him a lot of attention. Just, just kind of poo-pooed him at a camp once and didn't show him the love that he thought he deserved. And that was motivation in the TCU game, right? That they wanted to show Kendall Browse what he missed out on. And that's an example of these great athletes having to psychologically manufacture slights and moments of disrespect to keep that chip on their shoulder razor sharp, to grind it. I call it motivational currency. Players and great players, MJ did it, Tom Brady does it, and they do it by the ability. Baker Mayfield was really good at doing it because he came from an underdog mentality. But once they get to the top of the mountain and they really, and Shedeur Sanders will be a Heisman candidate. So once they get to that top of the mountain, they actually do need to manufacture these slights because they're getting way more praise than they've ever gotten before. And usually they use the disrespect, they use the slights against them. They use any type of negative narrative against them. They internalize it and use it as motivation. And I think Shedeur Sanders right now, because he's at the top of the mountain, but he's as high as he's ever been. And right now he's getting a lot of praise. And some tells me Deion Sanders, this is Deion talking to him right before he goes up there. You know, man, they disrespecting you out there. You look at all your peers, where you came from. So I think it's brilliant, by the way, because I think all athletes do it, and there are examples of it all throughout sports, everywhere. And this is another example of it. To me, that's what it's about, not necessarily about the disrespectful tone or the shot that he unknowingly or knowingly took at 6A high school football.
No, it is. It's the funny part about it is to be like, they haven't done anything. Like, dude, you were 4-8. Yes, you can't say they haven't done anything and you were 4-8. And I get you had a good start of the season, but you were 4-8. And there's other issues, but you could go 4-8 again this season. Good. You can't pretend like you have achieved things because your dad achieved things. You have done a lot of things, but you're also not in a camp above where you're at right now. You're a good college football player. You have a lot of potential, but you also have drawbacks. It's clearly what it is. It's the same. The story I always use was Shaq finally admitted to it. Shaq claimed that David Robinson did not give him an autograph when he was in high school in San Antonio, and that's why he had to go play David Robinson is so hard. And later on admitted that that was a completely made up thing, but David Robinson was too nice and he had to figure out a way to hate him. And so, and so that was what he found to do. It's annoying because people keep giving him platforms to walk out on and go, here's a blatant lie that I have to tell myself to try and be a better football player. But yeah. I get what it is. You're 100% right at what it is. It's just, as somebody watched it, I just have to turn away and just go, I don't care. Say whatever you want to say. We understand. It's hard to say, well, I grew up, being able to talk to any single athlete I ever wanted to in my entire life. Tom Brady's personally mentored me. But really, it's been hard on me because my family had so much money that I had to go to private school. I wasn't able to go to public school, guys. I wasn't able to. You know, and then for me, I couldn't get recruited because I told everyone I was playing for my dad, so no one wasted their time on me. You know, my life has just been so hard, one thing after another, that, you know, it's frustrating when people try and show when no matter whatever anybody else accomplishes, they have to go, no, but mine was just so much harder. And this is, it's not just Shedeur Sanders. It is a lot of people in life who have this mindset.
Yeah. And no, so, but like I said, I think athletes, they almost need it to a certain extent. You don't become complacent and you don't, you know, become, you don't get satisfied. And for him, like you said, you just named all the advantages he's had, right? He's had a lot of advantages in his life, and that's great. He's been a blessed young man, and he's taken advantage of him. He's maximized those opportunities. But psychologically, you know, and I remember Bernard Hopkins talked about this with boxing, and he started talking about like Money Mayweather and how everybody who basically the last maybe 10 to 15 fights that Money Mayweather's had, it's the biggest payday of his opponent's career ever. And they make sure psychologically they get that check. They get it in their account. They want it in there before they fight. Right. Want to get a good payday before they, so they can look at that account and get satisfied. Like, man, I finally got my big payday, baby. Because fighters, a lot of them were literally fighting for their life. They were fighting for meals. They come from poverty, a lot of them. They don't come from affluent households, the upper middle class. And once they get their big payday, a lot of fighters are like, this is what I was fighting for. I was fighting so I could change the generational path of my family and have wealth forever. I got it. And you go out there and you still think you got that edge against Money Mayweather, but you actually don't. You don't. Because you're a little bit satisfied. But he's great because he has that ability to conjure up the ability to always be the underdog, and he can get himself motivated even with the money. He's not satisfied. He's not complacent, but he knows most of his opponents are. So I think for an athlete, I think it's critical. you have that, like you said, it is, it's almost a superpower. It's like George Costanza said, it's not a lie if you believe it. They all, like, remember Michael Jordan on The Last Dance? They said, was it George Karl that he had the story about the dinner about that he didn't shake his hand at dinner or he didn't speak to him at dinner?
Yeah, something
was that
like
George
that.
Karl? And George Karl was like, that never happened. I don't know what he's talking about. I would have said hey to him, yeah. But just like Shaq, hey, he made up that story, and it's like I said, it's almost George Costanza-ish, where it's not a lie if you believe it, but they have to do it to motivate themselves.
There is a flip of that, which is we saw with Baker Mayfield, which is that can get out of hand at points.
Yes,
it can. And you can see the ugly side of it. And quite frankly, you can be that guy, and if you are not the most gifted, most athletic, if you don't have all those aspects, you're just a jerk. It doesn't make you great. So there's no inherent ability of being a jerk makes you great. But if you're already really, really good, it can help take you that next level.
You're just, that's so true. If you're not an elite athlete, it's like Michael Jordan would have just been an a-hole if he wasn't a great, all-time great basketball player. Let's get to some Sark audio here before we get out of here and get to what the facts, what the stats. He was asked about Anthony Hill specifically, because Anthony Hill is a movable chess piece. He was on the edge last year. I think middle linebacker is where he's listed at. But they want to move him around. But he was asked specifically, what is the plan for Anthony Hill? Here is what Steve Sarkisian had to say.
You know, I think the one thing that Anthony provides is versatility. Even as a true freshman, we probably, we moved him around a fair amount last year, with what he was doing at off the ball linebacker, what he was doing coming off the edge, rushing, what he was able to do for us on special teams. But he's wired right for sure. He's the greatest kid in the world off the field. I mean, he's a good student. I can talk to him. He can relay messages. He's a really good leader. When he gets between the white lines, I mean, he's tough. I mean, he plays hard. He takes it. He plays, as I always say, through the echo of the whistle. And that's what you want out of a linebacker, right? You want him with that edge. And so, I do value that from him. And I think that that's going to serve us well as a guy who's going to be one of the leaders of our defense, that's his style of play. Where he actually finds his home, we'll see. I just know that he can do multiple things, and so I'd hate to pigeonhole him into one thing. It's probably safe to say if we were playing tomorrow, he would play middle linebacker for us, but we're not playing tomorrow. And so we're going to try to put the best 11 guys out there and making sure that we're putting him in position to make the plays that he can make. He is definitely an impactful player that way.
I've talked a lot about versatility being intentional for Sark in terms of building the roster with versatile athletes that give you solutions to problems that are presented. He just brought up the versatility of Anthony Hill. Listen to what he talks about when he's asked about the defensive back depth and what he mentions as their plan for the defensive back development. Here's Steve Sarkisian.
I feel pretty good. We're like I said, we have some pretty good versatility in the back end. I know we probably label like Jade and Jalen Gilbo and Jordan Austin as stars, but we're rolling those guys at multiple positions. We're rolling safeties at stars, and so we've got really good depth. Obviously with Brooks and Gavin Holmes, kind of coming back with Manny has been helpful, but there's an influx of some young players that are getting some good opportunities right now and seeing some growth in them and what they can be with Wardell Max or Kobe Blacks, those guys. So I feel really good about the depth. We're gonna have to harness it a little bit here at some point down in August of, okay, what's this rotation going to look like when we get there? But for right now, they're all playing. They're all looking pretty good.
All right. Says he's cross-training those guys. I told you that versatility is where they're going. And here's another cut, the last one before we go to break here, him discussing Andrew Mukuba and what he brings to the table. And there seems to be a theme.
The guy who I just talked to after practice, I love the way he's practicing right now, is Andrew Mukuba. I think he's you feel his experience as a player. You feel him having the ability to play multiple positions. And I love the intent that which he practices with. He's He's aggressive. He's tough, but yet he knows how to practice. He doesn't go to the ground. He knows how to do those things. And I hope he serves as a really good benchmark for some of the other guys on how to do it. Like, he's definitely shown up that way and been impressed with that.
All right. So, like I said, there's a theme. I told you guys months ago, versatility is where they're going now with the back seven. They want guys who have a versatile skill set, who the rigidity of their system got them in trouble a lot last year, because they have some rigidity, which means you have a lot of rules if your system is rigid. And those, once the offense finds out those rules, I can exploit them. I can exploit your rules. If you have guys who are versatile back there, essentially it offers you more solutions when the offense presents problems trying to engineer and manufacture matchups that are advantageous to them. And that's where they're going. Like I said, I told you guys months ago what's happening now. You're hearing him start saying more and more. Versatility. Guys, versatile. Love that. Versatility. Cross-training guys. That's where they're going with the future of it. And I love it, by the way. It's a throwback. When I was on the 40 acres, that was the theme of the defensive backfield. If you go look at all the DBs who have been drafted, who have been on NFL rosters since 1999, almost 60% of them played multiple positions at Texas or in the NFL. All right, that's good stuff there. And thanks, my man Patrick, for that audio. Doing a great job. All right, we come back. We'll get into what the facts, what the stats. Got a couple of those to lay on you. And then we'll also get to the big fat poll of the day. I want to get back to that conversation, which is Texas football related. All of that and more on the Top of the Charts Tuesday right here on the Rodcast, featuring my man Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, right back on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time for a What the Facts, What the Stats segment of the show. Got a few of these from all around the sports world. First, let's start with Shohei Ohtani. Of course, he is at the center of a very controversial story having to deal with his former interpreter, being involved with a gambling scandal right now. So he's been a big topic of conversation. I found this. He's number one in terms of the top 10 highest paid Major League Baseball players. If you look at combination of endorsements and salary, if you combine both of those, he's at $67 million for 2024 estimated earnings. That would put him first. $65 million of that is in endorsements. So his $65 million he makes in endorsements is more than any other player is going to make in salary. It actually is, I believe, yeah, it's actually $65 million. It's $10 million more than any player in Major League Baseball will make in salary in 2024. Isn't that crazy?
Crazy.
That is freaky in terms of the money thrown out there. Yamamoto from the Dodgers. Man, Dodgers are spending bread. He's at $55 million. Max Scherzer's at $52 million. Aaron Judge at $40 million, just in his salary. Jose Altuve's at $41 million. Verlander's at $43 million. Mike Trout's at $35 million. So that's like your top seven guys. All right. Another little factoid here I thought was interesting. This is NBA related. So Patrick, you'll love this one. So how about this? The Rockets have four players. The Blazers, I believe, have four players. Sorry, it was in a game against the Rockets. I saw the stat. Four players who have four rookies who have at least 10 plus points in back-to-back games. Like each of those guys have at least four rookies, 10 plus points in back-to-back games. The Blazers have four such players who have done it. All other 29 teams have zero. So no other team has had four rookies score double figures in a game this season. And the Blazers have done it four times.
Yeah. I mean, they're playing a lot of young guys. So that's it's like them. The Raptors are playing a ton of guys that it's in that very much a rebuild mode and trying to play young guys. The Spurs are doing that too. They just have guys that are a year or 2 years or 3 years in the league. So they still have a lot of young guys on that team, but not rookies.
Yeah, not rookies. Yeah, but you're right. Yeah, the Spurs are a really young team still. But that, I thought that was an interesting little factoid, little stat of the day. And I had one more for you. This is NFL related, trying to go all around the sports world here. So do you remember the Peacock game, the NFL putting their game on Peacock, the Dolphins Chiefs wild card game?
Yeah,
they put on Peacock and people are upset about it because they don't have. I have Peacock because my wife loves me. She basically loves Bravo and all the Bravo trash reality TV shows, Below Deck, Real Housewives. It's all on there. So we had Peacock, so I wasn't complaining. But via Barrett Sports Media, a new study from Antenna, which is a media company, it shows that 3 million users paid to sign up for Peacock in the 3-day window surrounding the exclusive wildcard game. So they assume like those were NFL fans trying to get access to the game. 7 weeks after the game, the study concluded that 71% of the users who purchased Peacock just for that wildcard game still got Peacock.
Woo. That is good numbers right there for Peacocks.
71% of the people still retain that streaming app after getting it solely for the, at least they believe, mainly for the purpose of watching that wild card game. And you wonder why Peacock paid $110 million for that game. And in 2024, Amazon paid $120 million for exclusive streaming game, for one exclusive streaming game in the postseason. That's why, because if you can get that kind of retention on, you know, NFL fans just coming to your streaming platform just for that product, that's well worth the money. So Hope y'all enjoying Peacock. It's not bad. It's actually not bad. I mean, they got access to like movies on there, a lot of trash reality TV shows. That's mostly what wifey watches for. So there you go. That is the What the Facts, What the Stats segment. We come back. We'll get into the Shohei Ohtani statement that he made yesterday. Also, the NFL are changing a lot of rules. Competition committee approving and actually, you know, shooting down and disproving. They're actually banning some techniques in the NFL. One that has become highly controversial, the hip drop tackle. So we'll get into that and talk about it, break that down. We got Horn headlines on the other side. We are jam-packed today. A lot of stuff to get into on a Top of the Charts Tuesday right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers coming right back on the Horn. Welcome back to the Rodcast, a Top of the Charge Tuesday. That's when the Idealionaire, Patrick Davis, my co-host and the real MVP of the show, he comes up with the creative idea to play jams that reach the top of the Billboard charts on this day in history. My favorite musically themed day of the week, because you get the variety, because you get all the different genres mixed together. And also, I learned something new usually. I always learn something new about the artist or that song or something. So I appreciate the Top of the Charts Tuesday, my man Patrick Davis, always doing a great job.
This is one of those songs that is that I think a lot of people play at jukeboxes and then realize immediately that they're like, I pick keyboard Van Halen. Because you play Van Halen, you want to play guitar Van Halen, not necessarily keyboard Van Halen. And you just think, jump, that's a great, and then you play it, and then you're like, keyboard Van Halen, got me.
See, I didn't even know that was a difference, but I like that song. Is that the best keyboard Van Halen song?
That's probably the best keyboard Van Halen song, at least the most popular keyboard Van Halen song.
How long was the phase? Was it a phase, or was it something he just does?
He does it occasionally, but yeah, it was a little bit later on. You know, he did the first albums. Eddie Van Halen is one of the greatest guitar players of all time, so it was... You know, the guitar stuff is just legendary. And then that's a okay song. It's just, you're like, I'd rather hear guitar than necessarily keyboard Van Halen.
Yeah, he said he's just trying showcasing his musical genius overall. You're like, I get it, but I need you to specialize, and that's what you do. That's iconic all time.
And that's fine. No, it's just a really iconic song, and so people really know it, and then they'll play it because they're like, jump, it's upbeat, it'll be great. And then you play, and you're like, keyboards. I forgot it's keyboards.
See, once again, I learned something new every day. Did not even know about the difference between keyboard Van Halen and guitar Van Halen.
And then there's Van Hagar. It's a whole other thing.
Oh, see? I don't even want to singers. Go down there. What? They switch singers.
They switch singers.
Alter ego stuff? Or are we talking
about? No. Van Halen is two brothers. It's Eddie Van Halen and Alex Van Halen, the drummer and the guitar player. Yeah. And then they had a singer, David Lee Roth, and then David Lee Roth went and did a solo thing, and they broke up because they were all, you know, doing a lot of extracurricular activities. And then Sammy Hagar came in, and then so David Lee Roth,
like calling him that. Okay.
Yeah, David Lee Roth is sex, drugs, rock and roll, and Van Hagar's about love. Sammy Hagar sings about love, so it's two different groups there. There's a lot of backstory. I'm sure our listeners know plenty about Van Halen.
I'm sure there's a documentary or something about
tons,
like behind the music or something like that we can get into. But there you go. Like I said, I learned something new every time on a Top of the Charts Tuesday. Always thankful for it. My man Patrick also has the Big Fat Poll of the Day. We're talking a lot of Texas football. We've been hearing from Steve Sarkisian all throughout the show. He had his media availability, the post-practice media availability. The media actually had a media window. That was probably about 15 to 20 minutes. So they got a chance to look at the team. They were not in full pads. Again, they were in, Sark calls it underwear. We called them shells, just helmet and shoulder pads, because they had practiced in full pads earlier that weekend. I believe they had practiced in full pads on Saturday. So Monday they were not in full pads, and they obviously don't practice in full pads on back-to-back days. But either way, we got a lot of Sark sound, and my man Patrick's Big Fat Poll today is also Texas football related.
Yes, Big Fat Poll today on the text line 512-447-3776. And we got it posted up on X as well, Twitter X. You can find it on the Horns Twitter page as well. Who will lead the Longhorns in sacks next season? Who will lead the Longhorns in sacks next season? Can we couple of Trey Moore, transfer in from UTSA? He's got the resume. Ethan Burke led the Longhorns last season. Colin Simmons coming in, highly recruited, could be put in advantageous situations. And then we heard some audio earlier about Anthony Hill, where he's going to end up on the field and what he can do, because he is a heck of a pass rusher.
Yeah, you don't want to take that away. And right now, I believe that Anthony Hill is leading the voting right now. And you got, a lot of folks have already weighed in. Anthony Hill's leading 41% of the vote right now for Anthony Hill currently. Trey Moore is second, 34% of the vote. Because he's our best natural. See, Anthony Hill is, he's not a true edge, but he's going to be a movable chess piece they're going to put on the edge situationally. But if you're just looking at just the guys who are edge defenders for Texas, your best natural pass rusher among edge defenders, that is not including Anthony Hill, because like I said, he's actually at linebacker now, is Trey Moore. He's natural. But Ethan Burke was your leader last year. And Ethan Burke had a lot of natural pass rushing ability. And in terms of the frame, Trey Moore is not necessarily really impressive when it comes to his frame as a pass rusher. His BGO and first step are next level. So he's going to go out there and make some plays. And I think last year he had, 14 sacks and 17 tackles for loss. I mean, this guy, he's been there and done it at the highest levels. And then Colin Simmons is just a prodigy. So you don't even know how much he's going to play, but you know they're going to play him early in passing downs, pass situations, just because no matter how young you are, just like Anthony Hill last season, as a freshman, he was already one of your best pass rushers. Sark said it. Sark said, behind Byron Murphy, he's our second best pass rusher. So you can do that even if you don't necessarily have the technique and the foundation and even the knowledge of the system, and you don't have like the elite foundation and technique necessarily yet because you're a young player. You can still just go out there and rush the damn passer. That's something that should translate pretty quickly and pretty easily. So good question there for the big fat poll of the day. My man Patrick also will get us caught up with the Horn headlines, get us informed and educated on all the top stories of the day, and then we'll come back and discuss two big topics nationally. The NFL right now in the midst of their NFL meetings, so competition committee changing rules, voting on rule changes, and one is highly controversial, the banning of the hip drop tackle. We'll discuss that, and also we'll discuss Shohei Ohtani's statement yesterday that he made to clarify his role in a controversial story involving his former interpreter who was caught up in a gambling scandal and owed a bookie upwards of $4.5 million. And Shohei Ohtani's statement, as well as his lawyers, are claiming that was theft, that they stole that money. And that was reiterated during the statement. So we'll get to that. We'll talk about those two stories. But first, let's get into our Horn headlines. Then we'll come back and discuss some of the national stories of the day. We got Behind the Burnt Orange Curtain coming up next segment. All right. So don't worry. We'll get to some more Texas football discussion next segment. We're not ignoring that. We know a lot of Longhorn fans are hungry for some Texas football nuggets. We'll give you those and Behind the Burnt Orange Curtain. But first, my man Patrick with the Horn headlines of the day.
All right, your Horn headlines brought to you by Top Gun Rentals and Lawn Equipment. Texas women's basketball Sweet 16 matchup has been set. Gonzaga was able to handle Utah 77-66, outpacing Alyssa Pilley's 35 points to advance. Texas will take on the 4-seeded Gonzaga on Friday night in Portland. In the NBA, all three Texas teams were in action. The Dallas Mavericks stopped the Jazz 115-105 with help from another Luka Doncic triple-double. With the help of the Suns beating this. With the Spurs beating the Suns 104-102 in a game where Wembanyama did not play, the Mavericks move into a tie for the sixth seed with the Kings, who they will play tonight. And the Rockets were able to move into half a game of the 10 seed with a 110-192 win over the Portland Trailblazers. Jalen Green continued his hot scoring with 20 of his 27 points in the game in the second half. The Longhorns baseball team will close out a 10-game homestand tonight against Texas A&M Corpus Christi, where freshman Cole Selvig will be the probable starter. Texas is 25-5 all-time against the Islanders, winning their last five matchups, and that is your Horn headlines.
All right, so good news for Keelan Robinson and good news for anybody who's a fan of actual kickoff returns. The NFL owners have approved the new kickoff proposal. Remember I told you guys there was a lot of momentum for them to go to a hybrid proposal of the NFL's kickoff return and the XFL-style kickoff return, and it looks like they indeed have approved it. I'm seeing it right now from multiple different sources. So it looks like if indeed the, and like I said, I would look at the official NFL release, but if it is the proposal, the most recent proposal, remember this is a 1-year only thing. The best thing about the NFL changing their rules, if they don't like it and turns out it's a disaster, they'll change it back the next year. They're the most experimental league on the planet. Like, you know what? Let's change it 1 year and see how it works. It don't work. You know, we'll change it back. If people love it, they love it. It's what's best for the game. And so here's the latest kickoff return, XFL style kickoff return rule change. So the alignment, all kicking team players other than the kicker will line up with 1 foot on the receiving team's 40-yard line. The kicker cannot cross the 50-yard line until the ball touches the ground or the player in the landing zone or end zone catches the football. The 10 kicking team players cannot move until the ball hits the ground or player in the landing zone or the end zone catches the football or touches the football. The receiving team will line up as follows. The setup zone, a 5-yard area from the 35 to the 30-yard line where at least 9 receiving team players must line up. At least 7 players with their foot on the 35-yard line with alignment requirements. So that means you can have some guys off the line of scrimmage if you want to. And it says in the that a maximum of 2 returners may line up in the landing zone and can move at any time prior and during the kick. But players not on the restraining line must be lined up in the setup zone outside the hash marks. And basically nobody can move except for the kicker and the returners until the ball is caught. And you get rid of the high-speed collisions because they're not running now from 40, 50 yards away. Like I said, I got injured on one of those plays. Now these guys are going to be 5 yards apart, right? So you're not going to have any high-speed collisions. And at the most, they'll be 7 to 10 yards apart, depending on if they have guys off the line of scrimmage. But my point is no high-speed collisions. And even when they were having touchbacks, and by the way, the touchback had become really all that the kickoff was. I mean, it was a wasted play, it was a moot play. I think their touchback rate was approaching close to 70% of the NFL's kickoff returns, which is touchbacks. All of the kickoff returns in the Super Bowl were touchbacks. And the NFL, they don't want wasted plays. They want to infuse drama in every play. If there's drama in every play, you're going to stick around and watch that play. If there's no drama in the play, Patrick, you get up. Oh, I got to go to the restroom. Oh, I got to go get these nachos. Oh, let me go see what wifey wants. They don't want you doing that. They want you to stick around, and they want you to watch that play. Now, instead of you getting up when a team scores a touchdown, now maybe you watch the extra point because it's not as guaranteed as it used to be since they backed it up and infused some drama in it. And by the way, there is talk that they want to incentivize teams to go for 2 points, even more. That there will be changes there too. The XFL, by the way, remember they incentivize 2-point conversions. They even have like a 3-point in there if you want to, but they incentivize 2-point conversions too. And that's what the NFL wants because that's a lot. That's drama in a play. All right. And if you're a television show like the NFL is, you want drama. All right. Because drama is going to keep people invested in your product. So that's why now the kickoff return, which used to be great. I mean, it used to be one of the most exciting plays in football when you had your Devin Hesters, had guys like Deion Sanders returning kicks back in the day. Brandy Moss would go back there when it was a really important kickoff return. But now, because teams not only are afraid of the injury, because it's a high risk play, the highest probably high risk injury play out there, but also NFL teams, because they're touchbacks, they don't even invest in it. They don't invest in returners. They don't put their best players back there anymore. Now, because the injury risk is now lower because you don't have guys who are running with a 50-yard head start, all right, to knock the block off of your best player, all right? You don't have that. So you minimize those collisions. So maybe I'll put my star player back there because I realize now he's not going to be a target with a high-speed car in a high-speed car collision. And now you also will get more returns. You'll get more returns instead of touchbacks, and that is more exciting for the game. That infuses drama. And when teams now see the hidden yardage that they can gain from these kickoffs, because, guys, if you've seen the XFL kickoff, I mean, the return rate is like 90% of XFL kickoffs are returned. And we're talking about they get 20, 30 yards a pop on these kickoff returns, and they're not NFL-skilled athletes. So imagine NFL skill with more space and with fewer high-speed defenders coming downfield on you. Guys, you put Tyreek Hill back there in crucial situations, you're going to start seeing teams prioritize the kickoff return. I think this is a great move for the NFL. It makes the play safer, but also more exciting at the same time. Win-win.
Yeah, and you talked earlier about trying to raise the points. Being able to get better field position raises the point total. But, great. Yeah, I'm just anything that you're going to make things that – you had to take out of the game because of health and because of safety. I love being able to add it back in. I know there's still going to be people that are traditionalists, but to not completely remove the kickoff, which is where the direction it was going, was to completely remove the play from the game, which I think would have been bad for a lot of reasons. I think it would have hurt a lot of young players not being able to build themselves up in the special teams game. I think it would just hurt comebacks, momentum, all the things that can shift on a kickoff. To see that, I'm happy to see that they've found a solution, or at least a path to a solution. Because I agree with you. The NFL has been really good about, you know, changing things or even just adjusting, just making small adjustments throughout the season to say, okay, well, we're going to move these guys 3 yards again. And we'll see if that gets us what the results we want to see, or we'll make sure that they're getting too many returns right now. So we'll let you guys move right before it gets caught. So when the ball goes over your head or whatever they want to do to change the rules, they can keep adjusting them. But it's definitely, that's one of those ones that you like to see the NFL pass, because it seems like it's headed in the right direction versus some other things that we've seen for the NFL where it's, you know, where sometimes it feels like they're making moves just to make moves.
Yeah, no, this was, and I believe last in 2022, only 38% of kickoffs in the NFL were returned. But if you go look at it, 97% of kickoffs were returned during the short-lived 2020 XFL season. They had a 97% return rate. That's what the NFL wants, because not right now the NFL is looking at, you know, 60% of your kickoffs or touchbacks and the play doesn't even matter. And then you go to commercial break after those kickoffs usually. And, you know, so basically you got a play that not a lot of people care about. Most NFL fans don't care about in the extra point after a touchdown. And then you'll usually go to a commercial break. They come back with the kickoff. Sometimes they stay. Sometimes they have that picture in the picture. Sometimes they actually go to another commercial break. And think about it, guys. That's 7-8 minutes where you might have guys, these days, average Americans, young people have the attention span of a goldfish. I'm not making it up. That's scientific studies. You think 7-8 minutes when you're trying to cater to younger demographics, you're going to be able to retain eyeballs and retain attention and investment? No. They got other options. People, not everybody watches football the same way we did. They will actually go explore something else because they do have options. So the NFL is now trying to make sure that every play has a certain amount of drama in it. So NFL. So,
Why do you think Red Zone's so popular?
Exactly. It's all drama. It's a great point. Great point. There you go. And it's for the ADD generation, right? You know, people who have short attention spans, which I think all of us more and more are having shorter attention spans. Okay, let's get to this, the hip drop tackle too. This is something that also has passed, and it's been rather controversial. For those who don't know, the NFL decided to ban the hip drop tackle, and it's a 15-yard foul. Automatic first down for a hip drop tackle, essentially unsportsmanlike conduct, is a foul when a player uses the following technique to bring a player to the ground or tackle a player. Grab the runner with both hands or wrap the runner with both arms and unweight themselves by swiveling and dropping his hips and or lower body, landing on and trapping the runner's legs at or below the knee. Now, if for the folks who don't know, this is no coaches really teach. I heard D'Amico Ryan talking about this. Coaches don't teach the hip drop tackle. I was never taught the hip drop tackle technique. I heard D'Amico Ryan said he doesn't teach the hip drop tackle technique. So I do think most of the time it is something done out of necessity, just kind of desperation. Man, my body weight's going one way. I got to grab this dude. And I got to bring him down any way I can. It is actually a technique in rugby, though. It is actually a technique that is taught in rugby, and they describe it as when the defending player has a grip on the attacking player, one hand or two, rotate, the defending player uses that grip and swings or rotates their body to a position behind or to the side of the ball carrier. And then the drop is when the defending player then drops their body weight directly onto the attacking player's legs, as opposed to their body weight landing on the ground first to absorb most of the impact. So even if you are not necessarily by the letter of the law violating this rule, Patrick, anything that's even close to it, I think is going to get called. And there have been, and this comes because you've had a lot of notable, recognizable players get hurt, and it is directly related to this tackling technique. It happened to Geno Smith this past season, happened to Mark Andrews this past season. Tony Pollard, remember him in the playoffs against San Fran? That's when he goes down. Yep. That was a hip drop tackle. I just think because it's now kind of blistered in our brains, we can remember like that specific tackling technique and then an injury following it, directly following that tackling technique to that specific player. That right now is pretty true because it unanimously passed. Even the XFL kickoff thing, I think, was 29-3. It ended up passing 29-3. This unanimously passed. Every owner voted to ban the hip drop tackle. And they claim, based on their studies, they've done the research looking at 20,000 different tackles and tackling techniques. And they claim that the hip drop tackle increases, it actually has 20 to 25 times more injuries or higher injury risk with hip drop tackles compared to other tackling techniques.
Yeah, it looks like an extremely dangerous play. It's one of those ones. I understand the defense being upset that they're once again getting another rule that's going to hurt what they do defensively. But at the same point, this just always felt like a really risky play, and plays where you guys are going to get hurt so often and you're going to take star players out of games. It's just, you can't have it. And especially the tackles like this is when you talk about guys that are, you know, maybe rotation players at best on defense, taking out star players, that's never going to go over well. Because you are not talented enough that you're going to hurt our star. That's going to be banned right away.
You're right. Even at practice, that is a theme. Don't touch the big money.
Yeah.
Don't too hurt big money in practice. Stay off the ground. Don't touch these quarterbacks. Don't come close to them. You will get dog cussed taking a big time money player to the ground or so inappropriate. And trust me, that happens in college too. Even Mac Brown was big on that. So you're right about it. I think they are trying to make the game safer. I do believe that. The problem defenders in the NFL have is that 90% of the rule changes that are made, in the best interest of the safety of the game and for the overall good of the game, they seem to work against the defense. They seem to be disadvantageous to the defense. And that's why defenders are upset. They're like, man, how many of these rule changes actually are advantageous to defenders? Not many. It may be like two rule changes in the last 5-6 years have been advantageous to the defense. So with the NFL now, NFL scoring, by the way, dropping the last 3 years since COVID. And by the way, the NFL has put their best minds on it, and they can't figure out why the scoring is dropping. They hit a high mark during COVID, and ever since then, the scoring has dropped. Now, the competition level is great. The product is still really, really good. It's the best television show in America, and Americans love it. But the NFL also wants to be a high-scoring show because they're no longer selling physicality. Right. This is what this part of the hip drop tackle. Right. They're legislating violence out of the game. So they used to sell violence. Literally, when I was young, you was young, Patrick, you get a Sports Illustrated subscription and they would send you biggest hits in the game.
Oh,
they
would
literally show guys getting concussed. They'd show guys getting knocked out of games. And then we would celebrate it. Rome.
If you go on YouTube and watch like old clips, just the intro for old NFL people just dominate, just destroying other people.
Depleting them.
And you're like, this is the intros to old shows are basically 30 seconds of penalties in today's game.
Guys getting kicked out of the game. Yes, you're right. This is guys getting kicked out of games, nothing but targeting penalties everywhere. But the NFL celebrated that because they were selling it. The NFL basically was trying to sell sex and violence. They love showing any NFL intros had cheerleaders and big hits. Cheerleaders, big hits, sex, violence. It followed the Hollywood blueprint, baby. Sex, violence. It works.
Yeah.
Sex and violence sells. We love sex and violence in this country. So the NFL was selling sex and violence. And then they realized, damn, with the way the world now is changing, we can't sell sex really because you don't want to be, you know, in the post-Me Too era, we want to be enlightened about our attitudes about women and about the way we treat women, all the kind of stuff. So NFL's like, we can't be going there because there are lawsuits, cheerleaders who have sued NFL teams for wage discrimination, sexual harassment. So maybe we shouldn't be going there. So they're not going to sell sex as much anymore, not as many cheerleader shots, and they can't sell violence because of the concussion crisis because that would seem insensitive. So we can't sell violence. So what do they sell? They sell quarterbacks. They sell points. Fantasy football, all right? That's what they sell, gambling too. And now they're embracing that. But that's what they sell. So now you can't have what you are selling most, which is points. You can't have that starting to decrease slowly every year. So that's not what influenced this decision directly, but indirectly, it's influencing every decision because the owners are freaking out about why the hell are we scoring fewer points? What's going on? Like, solve the problem. And they haven't been able to really solve it the last 3 years. All right. So there you go. Some NFL discussion. We'll come back. We'll talk about that Shohei statement from yesterday as well. We'll do that coming up later on in the show. But when we come back, let's go behind the burnt orange curtain. Let's talk Texas football. Hear from Steve Sarkisian. He had a lot to say about his team. We'll talk about how he feels about this new look Longhorn squad for 2024. We come right back. This is the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers coming back on the Horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. We love the city of Austin. What's not to love? It is a great city, one of the best in the country, and it continues to grow and continues to thrive. And so do our friends over at Ironworkers Local Union 482. Many of the iconic landmarks in this city that make it so unique actually were built and crafted by the iconic, skilled craftsmanship of Ironworkers Local Union 482, like the Pennybacker Bridge and D.K.R. Stadium. And now this prestigious organization is hiring over 3,000 people for another big project right here in Central Texas. They're offering competitive wages, competitive benefits, even a pension plan. They even offer training for unskilled labor through their apprenticeship program. So become a member of Ironworkers Local 482 and take pride in the type of teamwork and craftsmanship that helps shape the future of our great city. Maximize your potential and accept the challenge of becoming the best version of yourself. Simply go online and apply at ironworkers482.org. That's ironworkers482.org. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time to get to some of the Steve Sarkisian sound and audio here. He had a media window for them to watch practice yesterday, but also a media availability afterwards. And Sark talked about a number of different things regarding his team. The first piece of audio, actually, I want to get into here is Sark. It's a coachism that Sark is starting to use more and more. I've heard him use it before, but something tells me now this season he's going to use it a lot. And I even asked Coach Bob Shipley about this coachism. And Coach Shipley said, oh, man, I'm using that way back in the day. That was one of his favorite. So it's an oldie, but a goodie. But I love coachisms. Every coach has got their own. And sometimes they're really cool analogies. Sometimes they're really cool little metaphors. Dick Schaefer is famous for his coachisms, right? He's got a bunch of them. And I love his analogy this year, talking about Apollo 13 and comparing his team's reinvention after losing Roy Harmon to open heart surgery. I mean, Vic Schaefer's great at it. And his ladies are actually going to face the Zags in the Sweet 16 of the tournament. Yeah, which is what I believe. And they play in Portland. Is that, am I right about that?
Yes, they're in Portland.
Is that, man, that's like a home game for the Zags.
I know. It is not right? Favorable. It's not hugely favorable like for Texas there.
And they travel. Dude, when I was flying up here to, as a matter of fact, that's crazy. I was flying up here to go to, obviously, Washington, and we flew through Salt Lake City. Zags fans everywhere, and they travel. Man, they travel deep. We were flying back into Spokane, so we were flying with a lot of Zags fans out there, and they're going to be traveling. I had actually had some friends up here that we were going out to dinner with last night who are Zags fans who were talking about traveling to go see the men. So those fans travel, and that's going to basically be a home game for them. Anyway, so the Texas women will have their hands full, but I love my man Dick Schaefer. I'm sure he'll have them motivated with a lot of his coachism. So here's Sark's latest coachism, the one he wants to throw out there, an oldie buddy goodie, about the thermostat and the thermometer. Here is Steve Sarkisian.
Right, we use an analogy. You can be a thermostat or you can be a thermometer. And thermostats, they set the temperature, right? They bring the energy, they set the temperature. Thermometers, they just react to what is set. And so we need more guys that take the field with real intent. We need more guys that take the field with great energy, so that the other players that may not know quite yet can fall in line with what that looks like.
There you go. You want to be a thermometer. You want to be a thermostat and not a thermometer. Basically, you want to be able to set the environment, set the tempo, set the temperature, and not react to it, basically. And I love that. He was also asked about what players essentially are right now thermostats, in your opinion, this early on in spring practice. And Sark gave a shout out to a lot of different players. Here is Steve Sarkisian.
Yeah, no, I think naturally, I mean, I thought Alfred Collins looked really good today, was very intentional with his approach. Baron Sorrell, Ethan Burke always bring it that way. But I think a couple new faces, I think Trey Moore brings it, you know, that guy, he's wired right up front. I thought, you know, Cedric Baxter and Jaden Blue again just kind of continue to assert themselves. And I'd be remiss if I didn't reference Trey Wisner. He's had a good, really, really good 4 days for us to start this thing off. So again, it's hard to pinpoint everybody, but there's been some guys that have brought it for four straight days, and it's been impressive. And so hopefully, you know, everybody can kind of fall in line with that so that they know what it looks like.
About the Trey Wisner shout out. I mean, that's the guy that most of us thought, oh, they recruited over that guy. They got in Christian Clark, and they got Jerry Gibson. You got your frontline guys and C.J. Baxter and Jaden Blue, which, by the way, he mentions. So he mentions your two frontline running backs, but also throws in there the sleeper in the running back room, Trey Wisner. That is really interesting, and it goes to show you the depth in that running back room right now. We know they got a great culture. They have, even before it's a short choice, going back to Stan Drayton. So whether you're talking about coaching or you're talking about players, they've had a really great room. Even going back, think about Keyonte Ingram is an NFL player. He was in that room before he transferred, and Rojo was the one that pretty much took the job from Keyonte Ingram. Rojo's in the NFL. Bijan took Rojo's job. Bijan's in the NFL. And both of those guys leave. Jay Brooks ends up taking the job from C.J. Baxter, who won the job initially as a freshman. And Jay Brooks is about to go to the NFL. And then C.J. Baxter, it's that room. It is among one of the best cultures in the country for a position group, man. It's been that way, like I said, for like the last four, 4 or 5 years, it's been a really good room. Stan Drayden and Tashaur Choice, they are, you know, they get a lot of credit for that. But when Sark mentions the guy San Antonio, he mentions three running backs and three defensive ends, three edge guys. Trey Moore gets a shout out. Ethan Burke gets a shout out. Baron Sorrell. I think that's very important. I think that is, you know, Sark pointing out where the strengths of the team are going to be. We know running back's going to be a strength. Just talk about the culture of that room. But we expect, Patrick, the edge position to be a strength for Texas. We've talked about that a lot. And adding a young Colin Simmons in there, a young prodigy, adding Justice Finkley as another guy that's capable, that group should take a huge step this year. That's where the pressure should come from. That's where your leading sacker should be. That group should be a strength when it comes to their transition to the SEC.
Yeah, and I mean, we've talked about how Sark is basically, you know, you have to build position by position. They started on the line, and then it's getting in skill positions. And then it ended up that there was a couple positions where he just hadn't been able to build them up yet. And edge is one of those ones that this is the year. This is the year that he is expecting to have that big growth spurt on the edge position. You know, being able to keep Ethan Burke and you know, keep the players that are starting to grow up on that edge, you know, have them in the system for a few years. So you have really veteran players there. Trey Moore is a veteran. Then you add in a young player in Colin Simmons as well to add some youth and a little bit of urgency in all these other guys that you better show up and play your A game, because this guy's right behind you and you know that he's got all the ability and talent to take the spot if you allow him to do it. So you need to go out there and work your butt off to keep that job. I think that keeps you culture pushing forward, that maybe when you didn't necessarily have the young recruits that could be starting year one, year two, that maybe the guys behind, maybe you're not getting pushed quite as much. But now when you see someone walk in who looks like a grown man like Colin Simmons, and he's ready, he wants to play that, then you have to show what you've already learned. And it looks like those guys are trying to take on that role and pass that down to him, that, you know, we know he'll get some reps this year. He'll be part of the rotation at the D end. But then how much can they help him be as a sophomore? Like, we know that Anthony Hill is in that position now. They're talking about Manny Muhammad and Derek Williams, someone being in the position of being leaders, pushing it on as you're bringing in more guys to try and fill out those positions. Can they be the leaders at sophomores and a really young player going forward? It's good to see that defensive end room and the defensive line, because Alfred Collins mentioned there too, as a whole, that D line looking like it is, it's good room, all those defensive line players.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up Alfred Collins. Good point there. So, because he's supposed to be a guy that makes that major, or takes that major step, and has that major leap this year. The running back room, we talked about, it expects to be a strength because of the culture of the room, because of the talent. Here's Steve Sarkisian talking about the running back room, the depth of that room, and what's led to that really, really great culture there.
Well, I think depth-wise, you know, if you went to, you know, call it 2 years ago, you know, when we had Bijan Roshan, we had Jonathan Brooks, Jaden Blue had already enrolled in school. That was a really deep group of guys, and with some experience, right? Last year was a little bit different in that, you know, with Bijan and Roe being gone, and Jonathan, and then you know, having Blue back, and then what it looked like with Keelan. And then here comes Sed Baxter as a young player, and Trey Wise. It's kind of evolving, right? As some guys move on, the next kind of guys step up and step into that role. We've got great depth right now at runner. They're healthy. They look good. You know, obviously with what CJ and Blue are doing, with what Trey's doing, the influx of the two young players in Jarek and Christian, and then Savion and what he's doing. So we're fortunate that way. But man, it always feels good until all of a sudden a couple of them go down. And then you're like, oh my gosh, we don't have any. And so we're fortunate that way. And obviously Coach Choice does a great job of coaching those guys and coaching them hard. And we try to give them a lot of reps.
There you go. That's Steve Sarkisian talking about that running back room and how deep it is. Maybe that'll lead to more of that pony package I want to see. You guys know I love me some pony package, two tailback sets. They certainly got the talent to do it. And every room every position room at Texas is trying to be what that running back room is, right? You talked about, you know, Tashard Choice is a coach right now that's considered a fast riser. You had Stan Drayton go from position coach in that room to being a head coach. You had Keontae Ingram there. His job is taken by Rojo. He transfers. He's drafted. Anyway, Rojo's job is taken by Bijan, but still both of those guys end up getting drafted. Then Jay Brooks ends up taking the job from CJ Baxter. He's about to be drafted before he was hurt. Could have been a Doak Walker Award candidate. Just a really good culture in that room right now.
And you're leaving off Keelan Robinson, who is moving up in there, was invited to the combine as a guy who basically didn't carry the ball at all last season, didn't really have many opportunities last season, still gets invited to the combine, will end up on an NFL roster because they found another space for him, because you also have a really good special teams coach in Jeff Banks. So you know, being able to say the guy who didn't play running back for us last year was at the combine. That's how good of our room is at running back.
Yeah, he just had, like I said, he had a really good day or a really good morning this morning, because the NFL just changed their kickoff return rule, and now they're incentivizing returns. Now they're going to have the XFL return, and he's the best kickoff returner in this class. That didn't mean much at all prior to the NFL changing their kickoff rule, but now. Oh, now it increases your draft value. I don't think he'll get drafted, but as a priority free agent, I think he'll have a little bit more value, no question. Okay, value. The quarterback position, one of the rooms that's hoping to become what the running back room is, right? Quinn Ewers gets drafted. Then an Arch Manning behind him. You start building that pipeline. We haven't talked much about quarterbacks, which is a good thing. It's not really a concern for Texas fans. Not an issue this year. Texas fans have more pressing matters than who's going to be quarterback in Texas, because now we have first world problems at the quarterback position. Not third world problems at the quarterback position. Here's Sark talking about the quarterback progression during spring practice.
Both guys are doing really well. You know, I think you can feel, to your point, you can feel Quinn, year three Quinn. You can feel year two Arch, right, of just kind of the operation of it, the anxiety lessons kind of year to year, right? Of what are we doing next? What does this feel like? What does this look like? I think naturally this year, probably as much or more than ever for both guys, their command is going to be really important. It's not just what they know. It's not just their ability to function. It's making sure the guys around them are in the right frame of mind and have the right knowledge to perform with them. Because you can't rely on the experience of some of the guys that we had a year ago. And so that's the challenge, right? How far can we push a Jonte Cook, a DeAndre Moore, all these new faces, a Ryan Niblets and the new faces to be elite players. And because the better they are around the quarterback, the better the quarterback is, right? And so how can the quarterback help those guys, you know, play to the best of their abilities? And so I think that's the challenge for Quinn and Arch of what does that look like? How do I make sure those guys are on point to do what they need to do to play to the best of their ability? But they're both doing a really nice job. They're both in a phase that you could see of in their progression kind of systematically, but also maturity of just players that have been in the program.
All right, there you go. Start talking about the quarterback progression on the 40 acres. All right, before we get to the off the record coming up here next segment, I did leave out one little, because a lot of the details about the new XFL NFL hybrid kickoff return rule change have been released. Don't forget, they're incentivizing teams to return the football, and they're incentivizing teams who are kicking off to also make it a returnable kick. So touchbacks that go into or through the end zone while in the air will now come out to the 35-yard line instead of the 25. And kicks that hit the landing zone, which is where the returners will be in the landing zone, I think that's basically from the 20-yard line back, basically the red zone. But kicks that hit the landing zone and go into the end zone would now come out just to the 20-yard line. So they're going to essentially penalize teams for not returning kicks that are returnable, and they're going to penalize the teams for kicking the ball out of the end zone for not making a kick returnable. So both sides like, no, man, we want kick returns. And the XFL had a 97% kickoff return rate a couple of years ago, and I think the NFL wants that. So they made it safer because the blockers and the defenders or the coverage guys are only going to be 5 yards apart, and now they're going to make sure that the kickoff return rate, the touchback rate, which was at 70% last season. Now it's going to drop precipitously. And Keelan Robinson should be licking his chops. He should be like, excellent, like Mr. Burns on The Simpsons. All right, we come back. We'll get into off the record on the other side. What the hell is going on with Puff Daddy? Damn. And that's the only word I can use to describe without getting us kicked off the air here. We'll discuss that on the other side right here on the Rodcast with Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babies coming right back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. You guys hear me talking about Dr. Eckert all the time. You hear Patrick talking about him. All here on the horn, we give a lot of our testimonials about Dr. Eckert and his great team and what they've been able to do for us, and they can do the same for you. He is the official dentist of the horn, and he should be your official dentist as well. It doesn't matter what you need. It could be something as simple as a checkup or a cleaning, which I went in recently for a Dr. Eckert for a cleaning and a checkup, and during the checkup, they found that my wisdom teeth were actually growing in sideways, and before it became a disaster for me, they wanted to make sure they took care of that, so they walked me through every step of the process, educating me, informed me about why they had to do what they were doing, why they were so urgent, and making sure that they got this procedure done. And I was back at work, guys, within 2 days. I was already back at work talking to you guys, feeling good, and now I feel great because my dental health and my dental hygiene have never been better. So I would encourage everybody out there, don't be reluctant. If you're a little bit anxious about going to the dentist, then Dr. Eckert is the perfect place for you because they specialize in easing your dental anxiety, but also in any general dentistry, teeth whitening, dentures, porcelain crowns, veneers, dental implants, full mouth reconstruction, even root canal therapy, or even getting all your wisdom teeth removed. Whatever it is, it can be something dire. It can be just something routine that you have to get done. Either way, Dr. Eckert is the perfect place for it. Whatever it takes to make sure you're getting the best quality dental care available, that's what matters to Dr. Eckert. And he also, your happiness matters to him because, you know, he understands these days it can be really tough on folks out there who don't have the quality smile that they really want, right? The quality of your smile can really affect the quality of your life these days with the Instagram era that we all live in. A confident smile can truly change your life, and he wants to change your life for the better. So he also has the ability to give you a brand new smile in just one day. He's always on the cutting edge of the technological advancements in dentistry, and right now he can give you a brand new smile in one day. It's not too good to be true. It's just Dr. You. So we're talking about a lifelike permanent solution. So if you've been told your teeth need to be replaced, just call Dr. Eckert today to learn about this complimentary consultation. You got nothing to lose, but you got everything to gain. So give them a call, 512-345-3166. That's 512-345-3166. Or visit drueckert.com, drueckert.com. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast. Time to get into Off the Record. It's going to be a tight one here, but we got to talk about this story. So a representative for Homeland Security said earlier yesterday that Homeland Security Investigations New York executed law enforcement actions as part of an ongoing investigation with assistance from Homeland Security in L.A. and also in Miami and local law enforcement partners and raided all of, or not all of, at least the homes of P. Diddy, Puff Daddy, in Miami, in Beverly Hills, and in New York City. The law enforcement sources tell TMZ that this case is being handled out of the Southern District of New York, and reports say that this appears to be tied to sex trafficking and human trafficking allegations. Remember, there are several civil lawsuits against P. Diddy that claim human trafficking and other acts of sexual misconduct and abuse. And that is what apparently these allegations now have gone from a civil court to now there are some legal ramifications here if Homeland Security is involved. So yeah, that's where we are now. They reached out to P. Diddy's reps. P. Diddy has not spoken out about these, or he has denied all these civil lawsuits, or at least the allegations in all these civil suits. He's denied those. But obviously, this is a whole other issue if federal authorities are raiding his homes in relation to human trafficking charges. What the is going on? That's wild.
Yeah, I did not know. I had to look up because I just don't pay attention to a lot of this stuff.
Oh yeah, it's been happening.
It's been going on, and then, but I literally just saw that someone post that yesterday, and was like, I had to fact check it real quick because it seemed like something that 10 years ago, if someone said it, he would have gone, no, that's crazy. There's no way. And then I just kind of heard snippets, but you didn't know. And then I was like, well, is this a joke about what's happening? Or no, it's actually happening. That's a terrible thing. So, it's not good. You figure there has to be some form of evidence that they've already found to allow them to get a warrant to be able to go do all these things. But that's not good. Not good.
They're saying he's not, because there was some talk that he was on the run because his private jet actually was tracked heading to like another country. But apparently when he was stopped at the airport and stopped outside of customs when he was trying to get on an airplane. We don't know where he was trying to go, but he was stopped there at the airport at customs, and he wasn't being detained, but he wasn't allowed to leave. And he was just kind of walking around. So maybe they obtained the plane. Maybe they grounded the plane that he was in. It was like, no, you're not on the rest, but your plane's grounded. Because we're searching all your homes, and this is something else we also need to search. So our warrant gives us, it gives us jurisdiction to search this thing too. So until we are done with it, you can't have it. Yeah. So he hasn't been arrested yet that I can find. But I mean, I imagine it's only a matter of time. They're just finding more evidence to make the case stronger.
It's not a good look that you're trying to go to another country as your places are being searched. It's just not a good look, whether it means anything or not. It's not a good look.
That's what we all thought OJ was guilty, right? Like OJ's like, hold up, he's in a white Bronco? Hold up, they're on a police chase running from the police after he's been charged with murder?
Yes.
Oh, damn, then he must have did it. That's what everybody was like. That's why Johnny Cochran was amazing, because everybody in America figured, oh, he definitely did it, because he was running from the police. He had fled the scene right after being charged with murder, and AC Collins was driving the white Bronco, and we figured, oh, and he was threatening to kill himself, and it was like, all right, well, OJ must have did it. He definitely murdered his ex-wife, and he was found not guilty, not innocent, but found not guilty. Damn, that's wild. Think about that, guys. Think about how crazy that is. If Johnny Cochran was alive today, he'd be defending Shohei Ohtani. He'd be up there with Shohei and the interpreter. It's like, I got y'all. Don't worry about this, Shohei. We got this. All right, let's come back. Matter of fact, we'll get into that Shohei story because we haven't hit the latest in that Shohei story. So we'll come back and we'll get into that. We'll also get into some Cowboys and Texans news, notes, and nuggets. I have some unfortunate news for Cowboys fans. The Cowboys may be the cheapest organization in the NFL. It's possible that they are the cheapest organization in the NFL. I'll explain on the other side right here on the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis on Lifetime Longhorn. Rod Babers coming right back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers. If you're sitting in traffic right now, and if you're in Austin, if you're in Austinite, well, you sit in traffic quite a lot. That's all right. We all have to get used to it. But you're spending a lot of time in your car. If you're spending a lot of time in your car, you want to try to enjoy that experience as much as possible. And I know that's really tough when you're sitting in traffic. But if you're sitting in traffic in a car that you really enjoyed and a car that you really liked, well, it can make your traffic experience that much better. Well, Apple Leasing can help you with that. Well, they can't help with the traffic, but they can help with their traffic experience because they can put you in a better automobile. Now, whether you're thinking about how run down and how old your car is, or maybe it just doesn't fit your lifestyle anymore, maybe you need a bigger automobile because your family's growing, whatever the reason, you need a new car, our friends at Apple Leasing can help you out with that so you can enjoy that brand new car smell. Now, they'll handle all the hassles of it, the headaches associated with doing your own vetting of the dealer and the and also the salesman, right? You got to do the research about the automobile you want, go down the rabbit hole about how safe it is and what's the best value in terms of your trade-in, all those different things. Well, my friends at Apple Leasing, they understand what a time-consuming headache that can be, and they want to take that off of your hands. So all it takes from you is one call or one click on Apple Leasing's website, and you'll get a quote on any make or model vehicle that you want. They'll even give you an estimate on the value of your trade-in right over the phone. They have the ability to put you in any make or model vehicle that you want. And like I said, a professional at Leasing can help you get the price you want, the payment you want on the car that you want. They know that your time is valuable. Time is money, and they want to save you both. They're going to save you time, save you money, and find you tremendous value. To make the process even simpler for you, they have what they call a simple interest easy lease. And that's right. It's self-explanatory. It's simple and easy. It's going to give you more flexibility, which is going to give you more possibilities and options to help you find the vehicle that fits you best, but more importantly, the vehicle that fits your budget best. Inflation is out of control. It is through the roof. Everything seems overpriced these days. That's why leasing makes more sense than ever. You're only paying for the part of the car you're actually using. So give them a call, 512-346-9977. That's 512-346-9977. Or visit appleleasing.com. That's appleleasing.com. Welcome back to the Rodcast featuring Patrick Davis on Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers. It is a top of the charts Tuesday. That's when the idealionaire Patrick Davis, he plays jams that reach the top of the Billboard charts on this day in history. And this day in history, he's been jamming some real good ones. And this is, I recognize it, but I don't recognize the artist. Well, I recognize the voice, though. The voice is what I recognize.
You recognize the voice. You recognize Black Velvet. This is a hit song. Alana Miles is the name of the artist.
Oh, see, did not. I
it wasn't a big name that you were gonna grab.
I wouldn't have got that. Yeah. All right. I recognize. So, what year is this? Is this like early?
This is 2000? late '80s, I believe.
Late '80s. Damn. Okay. Yeah, I'm way off. All right. There you go. Top of the Charts Tuesday. Learn something new every time my man Patrick breaks out Top of the Charts Tuesday. So appreciate his efforts for all of the musically themed days of the week. Also, the Big Fat Poll of the Day. So my man Patrick comes up with it always is a great source of debate here on the show. You can get into that debate, participate on the text line 512-447-3776. It is Texas football related. My man Patrick simply wants to know who's going to lead the team in sacks this year. There's already a poll up for the Big Fat Poll of the Day. You can go check that out via Twitter at the Horn Twitter account, at the Horn ATX, or hit up my man Patrick at It's Patrick Davis in the Twitterverse. I'm at Rod Babers in the Twitterverse. And I believe the latest results, let me make sure I get them here. All right, the latest results have, man, Anthony Hill with the lead. 41% of the votes right now say Anthony Hill is going to lead the Longhorns in sacks next season. And Trey Moore is second, 28% of the vote, followed by Ethan Burke. Ethan Burke was actually my pick. I thought he led the team in sacks last season. He's got some pass rushing ability. He's not your best natural pass rusher on the edge. That's Trey Moore. And then Anthony Hill is probably your best pass rusher overall, but he doesn't play the edge. He plays middle linebacker, so it'll be about how often Texas is going to put him in that situation. We actually heard from Sark earlier, which we'll hear from Sark again coming up next segment, or from earlier talking about what their plan is to move Anthony Hill around. But versatility is something he brought up as an asset, so they're definitely not going to keep him in one spot on the defense and make things easier for the offense. So that's the Big Fat Poll today. Well, we talked about a lot of different things. The breaking news for the NFL did change their kickoff return. They're going to make it a hybrid of the XFL kickoff return now, which is, I think, a step in the right direction. It's pretty simple, but one of the big I think the intricacies of it, like I said, are pretty in depth, but just the broad strokes of it. The players now, the coverage team and the players who are blocking for the kickoff, they will now only be 5 yards apart at the 30 and the 35 of the on the 30 and 35 of the return team. Nobody can move until the ball is caught except the two returners who are back deep and the kicker. So you eliminate the high-speed collisions initially because the guy's only 5 yards apart and they won't have that running start, all right, to turn themselves into a missile and to just blow up an opposing ball carrier. So you eliminate the high-speed collisions because it was the most dangerous play in football. And now you're going to incentivize returns. You had upwards of close to a 70% touchback rate. The XFL kickoff return is upwards of a 90% return rate. And now also teams who don't kick it deep enough, teams who kick it too deep, they'll be penalized because the touchback, if it goes through the end zone or out of the back of the end zone, it is now the touchback coming to the 35 instead of the 25. So that is an extra penalty. And the team that has a chance to return the football, meaning the return team, if they choose to not return a football that is returnable, meaning they let it bounce in the end zone, let it bounce through the end zone because they decide, hey, I don't want to return it, they're penalized because their touchback then goes to the 20. So you don't get the extra hitting yardage you used to get for a touchback. They're going to make you start at the 20. And if you are kicking a ball out of the end zone and not kicking returnable footballs, they're also going to penalize you because they're going to get the opposing team out to the 35. So the kicking team has got incentive to make sure it's returnable. And then the return team's got incentive to make sure they return it. So they're infusing the drama back into the kickoff. It is back officially. I'm excited about it. I mean, Keelan Robinson probably is too. Yeah, so that was the breaking news.
And we can throw in there for people asking about the onside kick. There is, you can still onside kick, but you have to be down. You have to be trailing in the fourth quarter and declare that you are going for an onside kick. That is the only way to do that now. The surprise onside kick is gone.
Yeah, surprise onside kick is dead. That sucks. I'm not gonna lie. That that is a bad part of it. But
it's a bad part, but it's also not. It's not like we, you know, that was the. It was something that you're gonna really, really miss in the NFL. No.
You so see it 10 times a year.
Yeah, and they don't always work out. And yeah, it was something that was kind of cool to see every once in a while. But also, if it was your team and it didn't work, you hated it. So it's.
Yeah, I'm not going to miss it that much. I'm with you. But it is one of the things that if you were a strategist, I mean, we've seen that in the Super Bowl, right? Surprise onside kick. I think it was Sean Payton throughout the surprise onside kick. So, yeah, you'll miss that. But I think overall, you're getting more benefits from the change.
I would trade the 5 to 10 surprise onside kicks a season for a 85 to 90% return rate on kickoffs.
Yep.
That's an easy trade all day.
I agree with you on that. And kicks are still from the 35-yard line. That still happens from 35 yards. So we're getting more and more of the details about the new kickoff return rules, but I applaud the NFL. NFL is the most experimental league on the planet. If it doesn't work out, don't freak out, people, because they'll just change the rule back if it's a terrible rule. But I think actually this is going to be really good. The other one was the hip drop tackle, which we talked a lot about. That was a very controversial rule change. The NFL is pursuing. And matter of fact, how about this one? And this actually may be the most impactful rule change, but they're just not talking a lot about it. The most impactful rule change actually may be the new change to the replay official. The more power they gave the replay officials. So apparently the replay official now from Tom Pelissero, Rich McKay, the chairman of the competition committee, said the replay assistant will now be permitted to correct certain types of incorrect calls for roughing the passer and intentional grounding. And I wonder how broad that new power is. Because, man, you can, if somebody got called for a hip drop tackle and you looked at it and was like, actually, it's not a hip drop tackle, man. He did not swivel or he did not roll his and drop his body weight. He'd be like, nah, we're taking that penalty off the board. I mean, that could be hugely beneficial for the NFL in terms of getting it right. If the replay official has that type of broad power to essentially tap the flux capacitor, jump into the DeLorean and go back two plays and go, actually, guys, that was not a hip drop penalty or whatever it may be.
Yeah,
so that's out there too.
That'll definitely be big. And it's still, they have not gone the full route of what they need to do, which is let us hear the guy debating it. That's really what his fans, we want to see is explain to us why you say, and so we don't have to hear the announcers guess at what the explanation is and then it's something completely different. Just tell us, go, okay, this is why we feel that's roughing the passer, and then we can agree or disagree, but at least let us know why you're saying it's roughing the passer or is not roughing the passer, because I feel like that would be, as fans, we'd love it, and the players I'm sure would love to know, what exactly did I do that you're telling me I can't do anymore?
That's a great point, because the XFL, just speaking of stealing great ideas from the XFL, because you stole the Skycam. That was an XFL idea, this XFL kickoff return. So they obviously look at the XFL as an experimental league that they can take some ideas from. And, you look at it, the XFL, actually, I do believe they break down. They have a camera there while the officials are meeting and while they are discussing the penalty or whatever it is. And I believe they bring the fans in and you can hear all of the referees and their discussion and their rationale.
Yeah, I know that
they have to justify it.
It wasn't the XFL, but it was another one of those spring leagues. And they basically cut to a guy sitting on a computer going back and forth with the video footage and him saying, okay, so what we're looking at right here is I'm looking at this move right here and I'm looking at his leg and seeing where the position is. All right. And I can see this. And like, if it's, if he's in or out of bounds and it's, and I'm looking at, I see the little piece of green right here and that's, you know, perfect. It's all I need to hear, because now when it's done, I could disagree with your opinion or whatever else, but I don't have this complete vague area anymore of I don't know why you made that call.
Yeah, no, you're right about that. Yeah, they could do that, more transparency. All right, that would be great. And maybe the NFL doesn't want that, because you could end up with some really, you know, controversial rationales and justifications for penalties. So the NFL may want to stay away from that, especially with sports gambling. But I'm with you. I think it may be something they should explore at least for one season. Remember, you can always decide to change the rule back. But if they did change that back, the NFL fans would lose and go. So you don't want us to have to know the reasons why you're having these penalties because you are, you know, fixing games or doing crazy stuff like that. Yeah. But either way, I like what the NFL is doing with their kickoff return rules and some of these rule changes. That's been a big topic of conversation. And Shohei Ohtani has also been a big topic of conversation. Yesterday, he did make a statement to the media. We did have some audio to play for you, but honestly, it's mostly him reading in Japanese and then his interpreter just saying the gist of it is he never gambled on any sporting events, that he never had any contact or association with any bookies. He did not know that his interpreter, Mizuhara, was taking and stealing this money, and he had no idea about his gambling addiction and did not give him money to cover his gambling debts at all. Basically throwing his interpreter just all the way up under the bus, and then maybe that is true, but he's basically saying his interpreter and really good friend went rogue. He went rogue and did his own thing. He was stealing money from him. That's the gist of it. And now, I mean, now the conversation shifts because Major League Baseball has their own investigation. And I'll just tell you right now, in my prediction, they won't find anything that disputes what Shohei Ohtani is saying right now about what happened. The only one now that can dispute it with some type of the credibility would be the interpreter himself, Mizuhara, and he has pretty much been tight-lipped since this became the legal ramifications, I think, have become more and more clear about, you know, what he did and if he's going to be considered someone who stole $4.5 million. So he is not necessarily talking to the media anymore. I'm sure that's on the advice of his lawyers, but he's the only one that could decide, hey, you know what? Maybe if I'm going down, I'm taking everybody with me and I'll throw out his version of the story and it'll still be his version versus Shohei's version. Then it'll be about credibility. And the court of public opinion, I think, believes that Shohei, although not he's not necessarily guilty, but he certainly is not innocent in this whole thing. So I think the court of public opinion will always tie this to the legacy of Shohei Ohtani, much like, you know, Michael Jordan has, you know, some allegations of gambling and his legacy as well. But I don't know, ultimately, unless the legal system itself and federal authorities force Mizuhara on the record, and on the record, he says, oh, no, I did this with Shohei. Under oath, on the record, oh, no, this was Shohei. Shohei gave me this. Unless that happens, and it could, unless that happens, I think ultimately, I'm not saying it goes away, but the Major League Baseball investigation, it won't have anything that disputes what Shohei has already offered up.
Yeah. And I mean, Shohei's in the place now that if it's not the truth, I don't think anybody really would have cared that much if he wasn't betting on baseball. I don't think it would have been a huge deal. They would have said, oh yeah, man, you can't be betting in illegal gambling. You're going to have to pay this fine or whatever else. And we'll move on. But now if you're throwing somebody under the bus and then that turns out that there was lies in that throwing someone under the bus, that is a massive character indictment of somebody. And
that's true.
And again, once you become the best and a $700 million man, there's a lot of people that want to find any reason to hate you.
I agree with that, bro. You're right. Yeah. No. And his there's a team around people who are as like basically their own brands, like Shohei Ohtani, and worth so much money. They have their own teams that consist of your manager and your publicist and your financial planner and your accountant. And usually they work together. All right. And their checks and balances. The reason you have different people because their checks and balances that, hey, man, maybe your accountant will find something that your manager's doing. Like, hey, man, did you notice this? Or your publicist will find something that your manager's doing or vice versa. So these things work as ways to check and balance each other. And I want to say with his team, if his version of events is true, his team needs to all be fired. Yep. And he needs a new team. Because I can't tell you how many people, whether the accountant or the manager or the financial planner, hell, the bank, get a new bank. If this dude could just easily send $4 million to somebody without having to go through a lot more red tape in that, I don't know where it went wrong, but if it is indeed true that he just stole the money, there should have been better checks and balances to catch a guy like that. That was too easy then.
Yeah.
If he sold it.
Yeah, it was way too easy. Yeah, and
way too easy.
I'm sure more of that will come out down the line and through the trials and the accusations of how he stole the money and everything else will come out in trials down the line. But yeah, all that is going to be a questioning because if any of it comes out that it's not kind of the way it is and that Shohei did have knowledge of the transfer and he was just trying to help his friend, but then was told that that might get him in more problems. So he said, no, I didn't do it. That's that kind of thing that it will come back to bite him in the end. But maybe it was. Maybe he was just taken advantage of. And, you know, the translator was able to tell everybody else, you know, no. He said it's okay.
Yeah. Basically, he can prove how close they are. And in proving how close they are, people will just assume. They'll make the leap themselves if I can just prove how close me and Shohei are.
Yeah.
And he can prove. Yes,
I literally my job is to speak for him. Let me speak for him.
I literally speak for this man. Come on now. But the reports are they were really close, that he, you know, him, their wives were really close and that they hung out a lot, which makes a lot of sense. I mean, he's your interpreter. You need him around, not just for baseball stuff, but for other stuff. All right. So there you go. A little show. And by the way, there was I said it yesterday and I guess I spoke it into existence. I said yesterday, literally, man, the NBA hadn't had to deal with any gambling issues. And I was like, that's interesting because it seems like a lot of the other leagues that this has come up in one way, form, or fashion. Like, oh, man, they got a player that's gambling or an association or an allegation where they got one of their first ones in the new age of legalized sports gambling in 38 states. An NBA, Jante Porter of the Toronto Raptors, he has been investigated for hitting too many unders. Basically, his unders were so hot and so profitable. DraftKings claimed that they were a couple of times, actually, it was the number one prop bet moneymaker on the entire DraftKings website.
Yeah, I think they said they saw several $10,000 and $20,000 bets on them, too.
Yes, they saw. Yeah, and the usual average prop bet, even if you want to get to the higher average prop bets, are between 1,000 and maybe 2,000. He said that's your big money prop bets. Yeah. Somebody's betting 20,000, 10,000 prop bets on Jante Porter's unders. Yeah. And his conduct, because in two games where they've been tracking this, they've been tracking for a long time, they claim that he had to leave the game because of illness or because of an injury. And the coach, is it Rajakovic?
Darko, I believe. Darko is what I go with.
Yeah, okay, I'm going to screw it up. But he claims, basically, he's saying or implying, hey, the player told me he was not feeling well. Or the player told me, hey, I re-injured something, coach. So that's why I had to come out of the game. And those are the games where all the unders hit. And those are the games in question. So there, I guess the allegations are that he fixed games or was a part of fixing games. It's an investigation right now. So they haven't proven anything. But my point is, that just shows you that they are working with several entities. They are working with data scientists. They're working with the gambling platforms themselves, whatever, the casinos and the apps themselves, DraftKings. They're working with, they probably got their own private investigators on this too. And the leagues themselves, everybody now is on the same side of sports gambling because they're making so much money. And they don't want to slaughter this cash cow. And the only thing that can slaughter this cash cow is if there are players fixing games or if the integrity of the product is in question.
Yeah.
And that's what they can't have. And the reason, and honestly, the reason Vegas kind of knows about some of these, I don't know, fixing methods and how some of this stuff may be going down is because, you know, Vegas, they rig the system themselves. It's a rigged system. So if you're going to beat a rigged system, you probably got to cheat to do it. So that's how they read. That's how they guarantee. Like, hey man, you're cheating. If you're beating this system, you're probably cheating this system. That's the only way to beat, because we rigged the damn system. So we cheating the system. So we know if you beat us, then you got to cheat to do it. There you go. That's pretty much the rationale there. So Jante Porter under investigation. All right, we come back. I promise you, Cowboys news notes next. So we'll do that. We'll give you some Cowboys talk. Mike McCarthy, what he thinks about the Cowboys in free agency. I'll tell you why the Cowboys are maybe the cheapest team in the NFL. The most valuable team in the NFL might also be the cheapest team in the NFL. And nobody likes a cheap billionaire. We'll talk about that on the other side. Also hear from D'Amico Ryans. Lots of NFL discussion and some Texas spring football discussion on the other side right here on the Rodcast featuring my man Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Reckless, coming right back on the horn. Hey, what's up, folks? Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers here. Let me tell you about our friends over at Callahan's General Store. I know that you've been looking at your lawn and you are comparing your lawn to some of your neighbors, and you want to have that that golf course condition lawn. You want your lawn looking healthy. You want it looking plush. You want it looking green. You want that lawn that all of your neighbors envy. Well, that's what I'm trying to get, and I've been talking to my man, Charlie Wilson, over at Callahan's General Store, and he's giving me all the tips to try to make my yard a better yard. And yours as well. So they got everything that you need for all your lawn care needs and all of your lawn care items. The resources, they're at Callahan's General Store. The pre-emergents are there, which are great to help you kill all the weeds initially. And they have that with such as Barricade product with Nitrofos. They got the pre-emergents. Put that down early. You kill all the weeds. And then you get into your weed and feed. I put that down before I left. The yard already looked great. The fewer weeds than we've had there in a long time. And we already put the weed and feed down. So I assume when I come back, the yard's going to look even better. And then I'll go to Callahan's General Store, and then I'll get their thoughts on what kind of grass seed I need to fill in those dead patches. They got the Bermuda seed if you need that. They got bags of soil. They got the amendments. They got the special fertilizers. Everything you need to make sure that your yard is looking better than ever. They can do that at Callahan's General Store. They also, at Callahan's General Store, they got everything you need in terms of all of your people with the green thumb who want to start planting all of your vegetables, even trees for the spring. They have that as well. They have native pecan trees, fruit trees there, so you can enjoy those for generations to come. If you're starting to plant those seedlings, they got the vegetables for you, peppers, tomatoes, melons, and other plants also available there at Callahan's General Store. They know Easter is arriving soon, so they'll have the ducklings there. They'll have the baby chicks there, the rabbits there, so bring all the kiddos out. They love that kind of stuff. Callahan's General Store, a one-stop shop, folks, for everything you need in terms of your lawn care needs. And the folks there are so helpful. They'll walk you through all the steps in the process. You can sound like you know what you're talking about simply by going to Callahan's General Store and getting their advice about how to make your yard the most beautiful, lush-looking yard in the neighborhood. Callahan's General Store is still there between 501 Bastrop Highway between downtown and the airport. Make it a Callahan's day. All right, let's get to this Shedeur Sanders sound. That's got a lot of people upset. Apparently, Shedeur Sanders was speaking to the media, the Colorado quarterback, son of Deion Sanders, speaking to the media about his mindset, being an underdog of sorts. And here's what Shedeur Sanders had to say that really offended some folks at the highest level of high school football here in the great state.
I came from a private school, so at the end of the day, I dealt with a lot of negativity, a lot of hate, a lot of everything I done dealt with already year after year. I came from a small private school. All the other kids was going big, Power 5, and they went to big 6A, Texas 6A schools and stuff. I don't see those same kids around. I don't see them excelling in their programs or whatever they're doing. So I always been against the odds, like in different ways.
Okay, so a lot of people got upset that he said he doesn't see the other great players from the 6A level that are thriving in college football like he is, which is not true. There are plenty of them. Hell, Quinn Ewers is one of those QBs. Jalen Milroe is another one of those quarterbacks. Those guys just played in the college football playoff. So, yeah, there are some players from that level that are playing at a really high level and that are thriving and having success at the college football level. But he's great. I mean, he's going to be a first-round pick. He's got a chance to even be the first running back – first quarterback, taken off the board next season overall. But I think ultimately this is about what a lot of great athletes have to do. They have to psychologically flip the script and turn themselves into an underdog, because a lot of them at time – Michael Jordan was like this, Baker Mayfield, Tom Brady – and I'm sure that Deion Sanders is probably trying to imprint this on his son as well, that you flip the script, because you usually internalize a lot of the slights and the disrespect. You internalize that and it becomes motivation, motivational currency. Players spend it when they need to, and they're just grinding that chip on their shoulder to sharpen that chip on their shoulder. And once you reach a certain level, once you reach the mountaintop or really close to it, like Shedeur Sanders is, right? This guy came from HBCU, so he used that as a slight or some disrespect, even though I think he was going there to follow his dad. But he used that going to Colorado and team, being counted out there at Colorado, even though he's had a lot of advantages psychologically, he has turned himself into an underdog. And the narrative has to fit the psychology. And that's why Michael Jordan still is as the greatest player of all time in his Hall of Fame speech. He's talking about getting cut from the high school team. This is why Tom Brady, we had the discussion last week, Patrick, about Tom Brady. Is he really an underdog? You made a great case. He is not an underdog. But the psychology needs to fit the narrative. And that's why these guys, you can almost say it's a bit of a superpower that they can flip a situation or a circumstance and turn themselves into the underdog. And therefore being able to internalize that and use that as motivational currency. It is fascinating, because that's what Shedeur Sanders is doing here. One of the top quarterbacks in college football. And yet he's pulling from the past and talking about, the 6A players, I was disrespected because I played at a small private school. And these 6A guys, they look down their nose at me because I came from a private school. And that was the elite levels of high school football. But look at me now and what I've accomplished. And in reality, it's like, well, you had your dad is a Hall of Fame cornerback in the NFL. I mean, you did have some resources available to you to help you achieve your goals.
Yeah, and it's always that fine line between – trying to get yourself pumped up as an underdog and playing a victim card. And it's very that thin line. And the reality is if you become great, then it's just emotional currency. And it's just you doing that. If you're not, you're just a jerk who thinks he's a victim. That's all it is. So you have to figure out which way you're going to be, but if you can go and achieve at great levels, but yeah, you sometimes writing those checks before you have earned it can come back to bite you, because, and I think part of this way too, is he's trying to get people to talk trash about him, because we know at the beginning of the season, everybody was talking trash about Deion and Colorado, and those guys did start off the season great. And then people started to respect him, and it went downhill pretty quickly after that.
Exactly right. Yeah. They need the motivation. They all wanted to act as underdogs and use that as a motivation. Honestly, for Texas, right? Texas last year had a lot to prove. They want to prove they can compete for championships, prove that they were going to bring Texas back, prove that they could develop talent, all those things. Now it's going to be different. Now it's about handling success for Texas. How do they handle success? We've seen you handle adversity. You did, you guys did really well. But now everybody expects you to be great. Everybody's telling you how great you are. How do you handle that? That's a good question. That it actually gets us to our Cowboys conversation. Because I want to, I said I would hit this, so I want to make sure I do. Mike McCarthy sat down with Adam Schefter and spoke to Adam Schefter about, you know, his, the Cowboys and their offseason. And just listen to what he said quickly about free agency. And I'll come back and tell you why the Cowboys may be the cheapest team, the most valuable team, but also the cheapest team in the NFL. Here's Mike McCarthy.
I'm a big believer in a second and third year jump. You know, we have some young players. We got some guys coming back off of IR that were young players that we're excited about. So we are definitely improving. You know, we're just not part of the free agent market right now.
So is that what Cowboys fans can hang their hat on, the fact that there are guys coming back that are going to be getting better because people keep waiting for the Cowboys to make moves?
Well, I think that, and also it's, I mean, there's a lot left. So, I mean, it's, you know, you'll probably have a market right before the draft or post draft, and then you got your June 1st market, and, you know, obviously we'll have another draft class. So I have great confidence in our roster.
And my man Patrick, as always, you threw out this years ago when we were working together. The NFL uses cash over cap, and it's basically a kind of a loophole. It's a cheat code for the NFL. In anything in life, pretty much, you pay cash for it, you get a discount. Pay cash up front, you'll get a cheaper rate, you'll get a cheaper anything. And cash for a house, cash for a car, same thing. And Andrew Brandt, going back to your theory about the cash stuff, he always says, cash is the only thing that matters. Don't pay attention to all the other figures in the contract. That's all a fugazi, a fugazi. It's all about the cash and how much cash you're spending. And the salary cap is essentially a mechanism to help teams kind of keep in compliance. But it's really all about how you're moving cash around and how you're spending cash. And by the way, the NFL forces you to spend cash. 32 NFL teams must spend 95% of the league's salary cap in cash each year. And individually, each team had to spend 89% of the league's salary cap in cash over 2 4-year periods, 2013 to 2016, 2017 to 2020. And they've actually even increased the amount of cash you're supposed to spend over a 3-year period from 2021 to 2023. So keep that in mind. You have to spend a certain amount of cash. And when you go look at the NFL Players Association, they actually publish this. All right. They publish how much teams spend in cash each year. So if you look at 2013 to 2016, how much the Cowboys spent in cash, they were 25th in the NFL in that 4-year span in cash spending. All right. The Eagles were number one, just to give you a little perspective on it. If you look at the period from 2017 to 2020, that 4-year period, Jason LaCanfora, he did the study, and he didn't include 2020 because that was a COVID year, and it's hard to find information on there. You're just telling you like that. I don't know what the NFL is doing with their COVID stats. But from 2016 to 2019, Jason LaCanfora, he claims that the Cowboys were last, dead ass last, in cash spending in that time period. The Eagles were one of the teams in the top five in cash spending in that time period. So in the last 3 years, from 2021 to 2023, the Cowboys ranked 30th. In cash spending in the NFL. So you ranked 25th in cash spending 2013 to 2016, 32nd in cash spending from 2016 to 2019, and 30th in cash spent from 2021 to 2023. Guys, they're just cheap. Now they're valuable, but they're cheap. They don't like spending cash. And what cash is, and you know this, Patrick, because I remember you talking about it, this is about liquid cash. Every owners, they're billionaires. They got a certain amount of liquid cash they can spend, they can throw at, all right, this NFL team. But some teams, they decide, no, I'm not going to do that. I'll basically prorate these contracts over longer periods of time. And there are some teams, they decide they want short-term gain, and they'll deal with the long-term pain of it. And other teams decide, no, I'm going to pay cash. I may lose out as an owner because I'm losing liquid capital. But I'll do that because I know that's an advantage in terms of acquiring talent, and it's an advantage salary cap wise long term because I'll be in less salary cap hell because I would have already paid that bill because I paid cash for it. I paid up front for it as opposed to prorating it and backloading those kind of deals.
Well, and I mean, it's the, you know, owners want to go, most owners want to go out and show that that's how they're going to affect the game. That's what they do best is go out there and spend the money. I think Jerry believes that his best asset is his brain, and that what he'll bring as a general manager means more than any money he could ever spend, which is just a lie and not true. But That's what he believes. And so he wants to, you know, he doesn't think he has to go out there and outspend everybody else to go win. But if we go back to what Mike McCarthy said, it is the general flaw in the Cowboys' logic of how they like to build, of we like our guys, in that, well, we believe a lot in the advancement of our players, second and third year guys. And go, do you know everybody, every team in the NFL is second and third year guys? Every one of them.
Yep.
So when they all get better, you're getting behind because they improved everywhere else. And all you did was improve the bottom line with them. But that's not a unique ability that you got. Everybody has those players that are going to improve. And you lost a lot of free agency this year. Normally you keep your guys so you can at least say, well, we don't lose as much in free agency. But you lost a large amount in free agency. You lost your starting running back. You lost your starting center. You lost your starting left tackle. That's a lot of pieces to lose.
It's a lot of pieces.
You lost a defensive tackle who's playing a lot of reps for you in Hankins. Mm-hmm. You've lost a lot of depth. You know, and to have all of that and then say, well, we believe in the thing that every other team also believes in. And that's what's going to give us the edge in the next season, because we don't want to go out and maybe overspend a bit on a player. We don't want to overspend a little bit. We don't want to take that risk and look like an idiot because we overspent. So we'll just go ahead and eat it.
Yeah. I mean, the Cowboys have the most cost-effective roster arguably in the league just because they build so heavily through the draft, which is the cheapest way to acquire cheap labor, right? Which is what the NFL is all about. Guys outperforming their contracts. They also are really good at developing undrafted free agents. If you go look at currently the lowest payrolls in the NFL, the Cowboys are the fourth lowest payroll in the NFL right now. But if you look at overall cap space, they have the least amount of cap space in the NFL. And if you look at teams spending so far this offseason, the new calendar year, total spending, free agents, extensions, waivers, and trades, the Cowboys have spent $11.1 million so far total. The Chargers, by the way, that's last. They spent the least amount of cash. They spent the least amount of money this entire season, period. But if you look at the team that spent the second least amount of money this season, the Chargers, they're at $39.2 million. So the Cowboys are, I mean, you go look, that's a staggering difference.
Yeah, and they had to ditch a lot of players to make room and go bring somebody in, but they had to, you know, they had to let a lot of guys go. With the Cowboys, didn't necessarily have to do that, but at the same point, that meant that they were trying to make moves and trying to change up things that weren't working. And the Cowboys, again, just for the third year in a row, believe that this will be the year they figure it out.
Yeah, the Saints were earning salary cap hell, by the way. They're projected to be $60 million over the projected 2025 salary cap. And they're still spending, you know, five times as much as the Dallas Cowboys are spending this season. So I told you guys yesterday, I don't know what's going on with the Cowboys. There is something happening. They also have the third most expensive offense currently in the NFL right now, and that's going to change too when Michael Parsons gets paid. They're going to pay Deron Bland. So this is a weird offseason for the Dallas Cowboys, probably the strangest they've had in a really, really long time. We come back, we'll get ready to wrap this thing up and put it in the oven. We'll play Who Said That. We got a few clips of audio, and you can play along in your cars or at home. Who Said That? We'll come back and do that right here. This is the Rodcast with my man Patrick Davis. I'm Lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers, coming right back on the horn. All right, welcome back to the Rodcast, Top of the Charts Tuesday. That's where my man Patrick, the Idea, you never plays jams. I reached the top of the Billboard charts in this day, on this day in history, I should say. And we'll be having a great time with that. Big Fat Poll of the Day is up as well. You can go check that out on the Horn Twitter account. And also, obviously, the text line, 512-447-3776. The Big Fat Poll of the Day, who will lead the Longhorns in sacks next season? You can get that at the Horn ATX in the Twitterverse. All right, let's play Who Said That before we get out of here, Patrick. We got a couple of pieces of audio. We're just going to play the pieces of audio and see if you can recognize who said that. We got a few of these, Patrick, so just throw any of them out there. If you're going to play the one I think you're going to play, I think that the people are going to be kind of blown away with what they hear. So let's play Who Said That.
True that you were stolen?
Yeah.
Child traffickers.
Yeah.
And you ended up being adopted. Mm-hmm. So how old were you when you found out that this was your adopted parents and not your biological parents?
I think they told me when I was like 5.
Did you ever seek out your...
No.
You don't know if you have brothers, sisters?
No, I don't. As recently, it's funny that a guy... How many years ago was that, Wendy? This is 6 years ago. Somebody reached out. My brother. My real name would be Fred Phillips.
Right.
And my brother reached out to me. I didn't have any interest.
Really?
I want to borrow money. You know.
Who said that? That is the great iconic Ric Flair, but he's actually on Shannon Sharpe's Club Shay Shay podcast, which, by the way, is blowing up. By the way, and he has a natural gift for interviewing people. Some people have that, like Larry King had it. My man Trey actually used to be really good at it too. I mean, some people just have this ability. They make you comfortable and they make you want to open up. Who knew that Shannon Sharpe was that guy? Because he's great at it. And that was Ric Flair essentially saying that he was trafficked as a child.
Yeah, I've heard that. And there's two parts to this. One is I've heard this story multiple times. I've heard a lot of Ric Flair stuff. I've watched a lot of Ric Flair stuff.
Yes, you love using Ric Flair stuff, yeah.
However, there's also a line to Ric Flair. So I can believe this is true, but Ric Flair tells a lot of stories.
He's great at telling these stories. He's been hit by lightning twice, if you ask him.
That's what I'm saying. And yeah, it's, you know, the stories change from year to year. Hey. And so it's very believable. Like, that story is believable. You know, his story has always been that he's adopted. So we always know that he was always adopted.
Yeah.
So it's a question of is that part of it, or is it one of the things? He's not as bad as Hulk Hogan. Hulk Hogan is the worst. Hulk Hogan, there's insane, crazy lies that Hulk Hogan tells. That he tells as so facts.
Not just exaggerating or embellishing. You talking about
like completely made up. Like
made
that,
up everything.
That he was friends with Metallica and they wanted him to be the bass player in Metallica, but he turned it down. Ooh. To which Lars Ulrich, the drummer from Metallica, said, "I've never met Hulk Hogan in my life.
Oh,
I don't know what
no.
he's talking about."
No.
So things like that, including that he made a tribute album to a kid that he met at Wembley Stadium that was supposed to be out there, and he was almost dead. Damn, so they cleared out an area, and then the kid didn't show up, and then they said, "Oh no, he passed away beforehand." So he made a tribute album to him, and then they were like, "Well, the album did happen, but it happened like 5 years after when this happened, and then it wasn't involved with the same people, and also you weren't at Wembley Stadium when this happened, and also Michael Jackson was there." Just like there's countless of them. You can look them up online. There, it's somewhat funny of how much lies are. Ric Flair tells exaggerations a lot.
Yeah,
you know, it's like, well, there was a lightning strike somewhere, and maybe it was right in front of him. Maybe it wasn't. Who knows? He was definitely in a plane crash. That's documented.
It was definitely. I think Ric Flair, I think he has had a lot of strange, crazy things happen to him. And he can exaggerate because his life has been so crazy and so wild that it could have happened to Ric Flair. Like,
if you believe it's the truth.
It could have happened.
If you believe it's the truth. And that time of how many times he's told the story versus how much he's drank, how much he's partied in his life, that there's a part where you're like, I don't really remember what the truth is anymore anyway. So if I think this is the truth, that's what the truth is, because I don't really know.
Well, and remember, I mean, he gets, and I believe it is, if I'm not mistaken, I don't know where he was at. You probably know more about it, but he was advised to live out his actual persona. like to live it. You got to be Ric Flair, which live like Ric Flair. And he actually took that to heart. He started living like Ric Flair.
Well, because that's back in the day, kayfabe is the whole trying to make sure that, you know, when you're in the airport that you're still your persona. Yeah. You don't let people everywhere know that it's like, but he kind of did it to another level when they were doing the four horsemen.
So he hurt himself. He hurt himself by trying to be Ric Flair.
No, the stories of them that they would basically be they would wrestle in California, hop in a limo, go to the private jet to Vegas, party in Vegas all night, private jet back, limo to the next event, and just like, do that.
Stuff was happening.
And you're like, no wonder you're broke. Because you can't afford to do that. Even if you're making all the money, you can't be doing that 6-7 nights a week in wrestling. It's crazy, the story of Ric Flair.
But that's the Ric Flair biopic is going to be amazing. It's going to be an Oscar award like nominee. I really think it could be that good if they do it right.
If they
get
the
right person, they do it right. It could, because it's just so much in it that it. I mean, you can make it a 3-hour movie, and it could be jam packed with just do. Oh man, it's gonna be really.
Yeah, anyway, but who could play Ric Flair?
I've had this discussion multiple times about because I wanna create a mini series about the golden era of wrestling. From the time it went from being regional to the time it became nationalized, and WWF and then WCW. But the key would be the casting. If you don't get the casting right, people are gonna hate it. You get the casting right, it'd be one of the biggest shows in the history of television.
It would.
If you got the casting right, because you got the cast, your Hulk Hogan's, your Macho Man's, your Ric Flair's, Brutus the Barber, Beefcake, Mr. Perfect. You had all these great characters that you can just bring in and out. Oh, man.
Yeah, the problem that normally happens with the wrestling stuff, though, is every time you're about to do a project, then some terrible story comes out about them, and you have to be like, crap, we can't do the story now because something else awful happened with one of our associates.
That's what's going to make it compelling when you find that Ultimate Warrior is basically a racist. You'd be like, that's good. We can use that. We can use that in the plot. He goes around. So, he found out that Hulk Hogan, Terry Bollea was a racist, but Hulk Hogan's a liar. That's okay. We can use that in the script.
As long as you don't use the phrase thermos-like. Oh, the thermos-like line in that trial is the worst.
Oh, you're right about that. All right, there you go. Good stuff, my man, Patrick. He's a real MVP for a reason. We love you guys. We appreciate all your protection. We mean that. Remember, the revolution will not be televised. We'll be talking about it right here on the Rodcast tomorrow. Same time, same channel. Everybody enjoy the rest of your evening. And until next time, hook 'em. Peace.